Here's the story for NashVegas. Several years ago, I started going to Nashville to have demos cut of the songs I was writing. I knew my old friend, Mark Allen, a great musician, had moved to Nashville. Mark had owned a studio in Atlanta. We had met when I was recording some tracks with Eddie Terrell. Mark got me involved in Derek Street Holmes's Then and Now project a few years earlier, and we had stayed in touch. Mark always referred to Nashville as NashVegas. I thought it was hilarious. I had started writing country music, was going to Nashville for writing camps and demo recordings. It was only a matter of time before the concept of NashVegas and a song would come together. I remember the song coming easily. It's a pretty simple story written in first person. The protagonist is from the back hills of Tennessee, Jefferson County. I remember researching the smallest county population. Turns out, as I found out later, it's where Cam's Aunt Jinx lives.
Hi everyone, host companion Devon Decker here. This goes on for a while, and I have to insist that to optimally enjoy this particular episode of the Say Report, you listen to Dale tell the story of NashVegas in its entirety. However, if you're like in a hurry and don't have time right now, if you jump ahead to the 11-minute mark of this episode, you'll hear that faithful Say Report theme song and the episode will start proper. Here's Dale with more on the story of NashVegas.
The protagonist never thought he'd leave home, but he learns to play guitar and sees the possibility. He quits his job, packs his stuff, and moves to the big city. He gets to town and finds a job working for change. In the video, he is singing on the streets, a busker. In my mind, originally, he was playing one of the many bars in Nashville where the musicians play for tips. He gets an offer to go play on the road, something most musicians moving to Nashville are hoping for, and he takes it. The hero meets a big star who offers him cash and a record deal. He never looks back. The best stories about NashVegas came out of the video for the song, which you can find on my website. Just click the YouTube link or go here. https://youtu.be/jhdiyzkw-z8. I had the basic idea for the video, but Donnie Manis, my videographer, and I usually just start shooting and end up with what we need. I was doing some investigation on shooting in Nashville and called about a permit. It took several offices before I got to the right person. They're all very nice, and it's not a big deal. I think it was $35 for the day. They would provide police to manage crowd control and ensure no one got hurt. Great! But they added I needed insurance. The problem is, you can't get insurance for the day. It's basically an annual policy costing over $300. Not in my budget. We were going gorilla. No permit, no insurance, no assurance we wouldn't be arrested. What fun! The week leading up to our trip, I had the idea of getting Elvis to be my big-time star with a rhinestone suit on. I had a songwriter reviewer tell me no one wore rhinestone suits anymore, basically saying the line sucked. I loved that line and needed a rhinestone suit for the video. Right off, I found Chuck Barrel, NashvilleElvis.com. He was great. If I've got Elvis, I need an Elvis car, a Cadillac. I started calling around for antique Cadillacs. Turns out there is a Tennessee antique Cadillac club. Problem was, they were all at their spring car show. I mean, all of them. Not an antique Cadillac to be had. Well, good idea. Some of them don't work out. But I also wanted a club to shoot some shots in. Something on Broadway. I called a couple and they had a rule about no videos. I finally got to Robert's Western World. Jackpot! Not only was Jesse Lee Jones, the owner and band leader, a great singer, he's also an all-around great guy. Jesse was born in São Paulo, Brazil. His has a phenomenal backstory. Check it out here. http robertswesternworld.com/about/Jesse-Lee/ Jesse He was not only willing to let us shoot in his club, he had an antique Cadillac, Ruby Ann. Lucky for me, he didn't know anything about the Tennessee Cadillac Club or their car show. Not only would he bring Ruby Lee, he'd drive her. Two birds, one stone. We were ready for Nashville. Oh, there's another glitch? The day before we leave? Of course! We were using an actor to play the hero. Donnie had someone lined up. He knows everybody in Gordon County, and they all seem to have acting experience. But Donnie's guy has bailed. Donnie tells me not to worry. I don't. Donnie always comes through. I meet Austin Olsen, the actor, on my way to Nashville. I don't know who Donnie had lined up, but Austin did an amazing job. Donnie, Joey, Donnie's business partner, Austin Olsen, and I head to Nashville on Friday night, check into the hotel, get a bite to eat, and head downtown to shoot some video. Rain? It's not supposed to rain, but it's raining. Luckily, there are awnings in front of most of the stores on Broadway, so we get some good shooting in. Turns out, as great of an actor as Austin turns out to be, he doesn't know how to play guitar. I teach him a G chord. If you notice, that's all you'll see him play throughout the video. It's a good G chord, but that doesn't say much. At one point, we're shooting a busker shot on Broadway, and somebody says, "Don't you know it's three chords and the truth?" I reply, "He only knows one chord. That's his truth." The rain slacks off, and we get some good footage at Roberts and on Broadway. I thought we might lose Austin all the ladies, young and old, who thought he was an up-and-coming country star. The next morning, we're up and at him again. Over to the famous RCA Studio B on the corner of Music Square and Royal Cuff Drive, Broadway, Grund Guitars, the Old Ryman Theater. Outside the Old Ryman, we shot a lot with Ruby Ann, Jesse Lee, and Chuck/Elvis. We basically camped out there for a couple of hours. A crowd of 100+ watched on. We had a blast with folks from all over the country. A local TV station took some video of us. No police, though. Don't ask for permission. Ask for forgiveness was the theme of the day. Interestingly, nobody asked a single question. We had finished at the Ryman and were headed back to Broadway for some last shots. You'll note the wad of cash Elvis has for Austin in the Ryman shots. It was two stacks of ones, $100. But to make it pass a closer test, I had put $100 bills on the outside of the stacks. $500 is a lot of money, but nothing close to the $10,000 it looked like. As we finished shooting, I put the cash in my back pocket. As we started down Broadway, a guy came up to me and whispered, "Excuse me, but your money is hanging out of your back pocket." Translated as, "Are you crazy? There's $10,000 hanging out of your back pocket." I love country music fans. Honest as the day is long, and the night too. My favorite part of the video is during the choruses in front of the mansions. I knew we had to have those shots. We had shot Friday night all day Saturday, and we're worn out. But we had one more round to go. We need some mansions. So we headed out towards Franklin. Big houses, but nothing was just right. We had driven 10 miles or more, and there it was. Across the street from a church, we pulled into the church parking lot, scoped out the situation, strapped on the cameras and guitar. We ran across the 4-lane highway and started shooting. I don't know if anybody was home, but can you imagine that conversation? "Honey, there are men in our driveway with cameras, and one has a guitar? Don't go out there!" As quick as we were there, we were gone. Well, a couple of choruses later. "I'm not sure that's it," I contemplated as I checked the map for another possibility. "I've got one more place," I said. I had found the perfect location. I checked my phone and followed the map to a pretty exclusive neighborhood. Big houses, big lawns, big fences. It's up here on the right. I drove past it slowly, turned around, and parked in the yard across from it. What's this? The governor's mansion, I said proudly. Well, I guess it's time we got arrested, Donnie sighed. No arrest. Great shot. You can hear a sample of NashVegas at https://russstill.com/white-lignin/. And check out track 3. You can buy the whole CD there or buy the song on iTunes under Russ Still and the Moonshiners.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Say Report. I'm your host, Devon Decker, joined as always by my host companion, Sejohn Sarawick. And welcome from the cold open of Dale Decker telling you the story behind NashVegas. I'm sorry that of all the Say Report promises we've made, this is the one that we made good on.
So are we just rolling right into it?
We're rolling right into it.
I didn't realize we were throwing a tag on this one.
Yeah,
so.
Dale told the story beforehand. She read the post off of Russ Still's blog. And I apologize because you've just heard it, but I am going to reference some things. I don't know, CJ, did you read the blog post?
I can't even get it to come up.
I don't know.
Worst design websites ever.
Well... I'm going to let you say your issues with the video by Russ Still and the Moonshiners, because you said you had some commentary to share.
Well, let's limit this down. I got one giant piece of feelings about it that, like, I feel should be out there, and you can then either confirm or deny whether or not I'm reading the room correctly on this one.
Yep.
But, like, go ahead.
No. I'm making sure that I'm ready to go, so go for it.
Okay, that feels like the most touristy, paid for by the city of Nashville release I've heard ever. the closest I think that can come to it is like, what was the song that what's his nuts from Bare Naked Ladies released for Canada a few years ago? Oh, it was like,
I hate that song.
But like, because it feels like it's this like contract obligation. I'm gonna make sure to mention every little piece of this in the area. But then, like, that is on the back of the lyrics being so disconnected from what the rest of the song feels like. Because I say that it feels like it's this really big touristy, like, come to Nashville, this is where you're gonna come to get famous, blah blah blah. But it's like listening to.
Just to say it, that Stephen Page song is Canada Loves You Back.
Oh, yeah. Yes, there it is.
Stephen
Page is, that song exactly. But the lyrics, it's like listening to Because I Got High and realizing after like the 10th listen that like it actually is an anti-drug song, right? Is like the first couple of times you listen to this, you're like, yeah, Nashville, NashVegas, let's all go to NashVegas where the music is good and the bars are awesome and there's neon lights everywhere. But then if you listen to the lyrics a few times, you start to go, actually, he's describing a dystopian nightmare.
It's so famous that they call it NashVegas. If a place is famous, isn't it usually referred to by its actual name?
Like, it's so famous, we call it after a different city. But also the entire concept of sell your soul for the music industry just so that you can get into this big mansion, which they then go to show you a big mansion, which is probably an acre back behind a wrought iron fence, keeping you separated from the rest of the mongrels in the city. Like, the visualization, I think, is really what keyed me into maybe listen to the actual lyrics. And then you listen to the actual lyrics, and the lyrics are basically just like, yeah, you grow up loving music, and you play it with your friends all the time, so why not sell out and never be friends with them again? And you're just like, whoa, what the fuck?
All right. So this is good. If you listen to Dale, which you did, it's how we started it. The disconnect is hilarious. Because that house, that big mansion that's behind a fence, it is the governor's mansion of Tennessee. I will reread this thing. Sorry to anyone who heard, to everybody who heard Dale just say this. They wanted to get a picture in front of a mansion. It starts mid-sentence. I'm not sure that's it, I contemplated as I checked the map for another possibility. I've got one more place, I said. I had found the perfect location. Checked my phone, followed the map to a pretty exclusive neighborhood. Big houses, big lawns, big fences. It's up here on the right. I drove past it slowly, turned around, and parked in the yard across from it. What's this? The governor's mansion, I said proudly. Well, I guess it's time we got arrested, Donnie sighed. No arrest, great shot. No arrest, awkward as fucking hell shot.
Well, great is not the adjective. That becomes my next question then. Am I to understand that the juxtaposition that I was feeling, this is how we're going to talk about this song, people, buckle the fuck up. The juxtaposition that I was feeling talking about, like listening to this music, seeing this video, and then realizing after my now second time listening to the song, just to clue everybody into exactly what happened before we started. Is that the point? Is it ironic, I guess, is the question? Is the song supposed to sound like a touristy song, but then the more you listen to it, you realize, oh my God, things are terrible in the country music industry? Because, like, it just, all it did was highlight for me all of the same criticisms that country music across the board has just been getting for the last 20, 30 years since Achy Breaky Heart, right? Like, I we've talked about this a little bit before, but, like, the commercialization of country music is, like, a huge problem in that genre still to this day.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
still
very
things
much
that are talked
so.
About and discussed. Yeah, so is this a song that is playing on that? Is that what I'm supposed to understand? Because, like, I kind of, in that way, I applaud the effort, for sure. I don't know how well it worked, considering I listened to it twice now and both times just thought it was one of those songs. But, hey, I mean, that could just be on me, right? It's like that guy that listens to Weird Al a few times and just thinks that's the original version. Like, yeah, that happens to some people. That's fair.
So I know that we do not keep extensive records of where the Great Pumpkin visits every October. I know that we're not allowed to do that because the three things we don't talk about are religion, politics, and the Great Pumpkin. And anytime I've tried to start a website about the Great Pumpkin, I get immediately shut down by a shadowy government organization. I believe that the year that this song released, which I think was 2014, possibly 2017, if we could check the records of where the Great Pumpkin visited, we would have found it would have been NashVegas. Please tell me you heard the air quotes in that, because this is one of the most sincere songs I feel has ever been recorded. I don't think there's an ounce of sarcasm. I think the fact that you listen to this country's music song, Sejohn, and say, man, that feels like it really highlights all of the problems with the commercialization and over-commercialization of country music. It's the fact that that's just what the genre has become. Because this song, when you read or listen to Dale tell the story behind this song, this guy seems so sincere about everything that he's doing. The thing that really gets to me is that you can't buy insurance for a day in Nashville. You need to buy an annual policy that costs over $300, which I have to be honest with you, to have insurance in the city of Nashville for over $300. Let's say over $300 is $400.
Yeah,
right?
These are the worst song lyrics ever. I can't believe this is what's in the song.
Yeah, right? But I'm just saying, like, the annual policy costs over $300. You're covered for anything that happens on any sort of production work that you're doing in Nashville. Now, let's be honest. Between you, me, and the truth, that is a way that Nashville basically scams people who busk in that city, right? You have to give us $300 because if something happens to you, like, we're not going to be liable unless you've paid this, like, performer tax, right?
It's a license. Yeah, it's essentially a license. Busking licenses exist in...
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but
it's an insurance policy. You also need to get an insurance policy for the city of Nashville before you do anything on camera there, or things like that. Like, you're supposed to have it.
Okay.
He says, we couldn't get insurance for a day. It has to be an annual policy that's over $300. Not in my budget. We were going gorilla. No permit, no insurance, no assurance we wouldn't be arrested. What fun, is the exact quote from his story behind this song.
Yeah, but okay. See, okay. So to highlight some of the stuff that we've talked about, right, with the whole like country music commercialization and the softening of, right? Like, you're talking about a genre of music in which people used to like bounce over the border to Mexico to go to what were called like border blasters and radio stations in order to perform their music, because in Mexico they were allowed to fucking send out at 500 kilowatts, which basically overtook like more than half of the American like USA like yep. land could pick up that radio station, whereas in the US they were limited down into like I think the fucking like teens. Yep. So like they could barely get out of their like towns, cities, states, that kind of thing, right? So like you had a genre of music that thrived on like legally often like running off into the night, usually away from like some charge that you were probably trying to avoid, drugs, like, domestic abuse, some nonsense like that you just fucking ran off into the night to get away from. You would hop over the border and play some music on the Mexican radio stations. To have that concept in your blood of your genre of music, and then have a guy talk about how they were about to possibly get arrested for just not purchasing insurance, $300, not even over $500, which I think is where it starts to get into like federal territory.
Yeah, right. Like
this, this idea of
costing over
$300. This idea that was why they would be arrested is so insulting to the history of the music.
Yeah, I agree. And it has to be less than $500. Like, the fact that costing over $300 is so specific a number, right? Like, you have to buy an annual insurance policy, not in the budget. The fact that he felt the need to put that insurance policy cost $300, over $300, means that it was probably, like, $310.
It can't be over $400. Like, you are very much limiting what you were saying in that moment, right? Like, if you said over $1,000, then that is $1,000 worth of play. That could be up to $1,900, and I would still give it to you that was over $1,000, right? But when you say over $300, if you tell me it's then $800, I'm like, dude, you undersold it. So if you're saying if your line is over $300, and this is not to be like $300, why did you just pay it? Because like I get it, like art, like as an artist coming up in the world,
right?
Not wanting to pay for something that also something that you don't maybe necessarily morally believe in. Like I'm all for that, right? Right, but like that's not the way he presents himself that in the music video, and it is not the way in which they talk about the issue, right? So contextually, it's a fucking goofy-ass thing.
Well, so they had $500, seems to be what they had, because that scene where Elvis Presley comes up out of a Cadillac limo that one of the Blues Brothers is the chauffeur for and hands Austin Olsen, the actor portraying the would-be musician in this song. And we do have to talk about that's what I thought you were going to highlight, because there's one glaring thing about his performance that I'd really like to make sure you and I actually comment on.
Let's talk about it.
But $500 is a lot of money, but nothing close to the $10,000 it looked like in the film. So they just got a bunch of ones and $100 bill and then put it in a thing for that scene where Elvis is like, oh, thank you very much. I'm going to sign you. Come on and sell your soul to the music industry.
Ah, the My Cousin Vinny.
Exactly. But it's just like, oh, okay. But also, as I have to ask this question, Elvis Presley's more closely associated with Memphis, right? Like, would Elvis be the one who drives up in Nashville to be like, here's a music contract?
I think that Nashville is considered the music capital, right? Like, that's the biggest thing about the NashVegas thing for me, is that Nashville on its own is already pretty fucking baller.
Yeah.
Tying its wagon to Las Vegas was a weird choice. But if you think about it from the ironic standpoint, again, this comes through kind of in when you start thinking about some of the lyrics in the song and stuff, is like, when people call it Nash Vegas, are they trying to be mean, right? Or, you know, not even necessarily mean, but like knowingly like pointed in what they're saying, right? Like when they call it Nash Vegas, are they talking about the selling out? Are they talking about the veneer that has been thrown over the actual glorious city of Nashville, right? When you call it Nashville, you're paying it its respect. Nash Vegas feels disrespectful in some way to me, right? So there's that whole aspect to it where if that's kind of the point, then like, yeah, like I get that. But there's this... Yeah, there's just this whole idea that like Nashville somehow needs to play itself up, which I think is fucking ridiculous. And maybe this is 2024, me, you know, only growing up in the last 30 some odd years, so like maybe I'm missing something from before that. But like as far as I have always known Nashville, Nashville's pretty baller on its own. It doesn't need to be Nash Vegas. And to that point with what you're asking specifically about the Elvis stuff, yeah, Memphis, but like Nashville is that'd be like feeling weird that he showed up in LA. It's like, no, I mean, it's Elvis, and LA is a pretty popular city. Nashville's a place I'm sure he was pretty often in his life, right?
Yeah, but I think to me, what it represents is the fact that, like, I had to come all the way from Memphis to Nashville to sign you, no, son.
What really fucking sucks is why don't you emulate somebody like Dolly Parton?
Yeah, right. Somebody who, like, I mean, you have that beautiful shot of the studio with the placard of all the people who recorded there. Like, so why isn't it anyone who's like that? And also, I mean, like, this story is great because of the fact that, like, we wanted to rent a Cadillac, but every Cadillac was at this famous Cadillac convention that's going on in Tennessee. It's just like, so they get Ruby Ann because they find a guy who, like, was just... They were going to use his shop and bar for like shots of in the video.
This is like hearing the worst person you know make a good point, right? Like that meme that's going around right now, or like the somebody that you somebody getting it right for all the wrong reasons is what this feels like. Like, yeah. This is what I love to hear about with like little guys making like music videos for themselves and having this kind of like having this kind of song that is embracing this larger thing. If only they were trying to be more ironic in, about it, if they were trying to point out more with it, do more with it, it would be so much more interesting song.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I also have a real issue with the lyric, wildest town east of Mississippi. Miami still is east of Mississippi, right? That hasn't slipped to the west of Mississippi.
It depends on how fucking wild you want to talk about getting. I mean, you've got the Jersey Shore.
Right? Like, there are other... But, like, the first thing that jumps to mind is Will Smith in Miami. Miami is the place where the sun set low. Miami, the place where the homeboys go. Every day is like a Mardi Gras. Is every day like a Mardi Gras 2 in freaking Nash Vegas? I don't know. I mean, it's music. It's what it is. But I did, like, Nash Vegas came to me, the term, because a DJ said, you will win tickets and you'll get to go down to Nash Vegas. And I didn't know that there was a venue called that at the time. I don't even think that that's what they were referring to. And I'm just like, man, what a stupid term for Nashville. I've been to Nashville 3 times when I was 7. Right before they knocked down Opryland. So I got to visit Opryland. I got to see, like, alligators. Didn't really appreciate it, but, it was this crazy time. I went again when I was 16. It's where I bought the cowboy hat that I have worn for every country Devon performance I have ever made. And so it means something. Like, I bought my cowboy hat in Nashville. And then whenever I perform songs as country Devon, that's the hat I'm wearing. And then the last one was to go to a comedy club the weekend I bought The Spark. And that was a great night. I mentioned last episode, I met Sam Levine. I met frickin' Bobby Lee. I had this exciting adventure. People that I met on that trip have since come and visited me in Rhode Island. Like, it was this incredible time. But, like, I think of Nashville as, like, yeah, pretty fucking baller. It don't need a derivative nickname, right? Like... And certainly not one derivative of Las Vegas, right? I would sooner call Memphis like a Las Vegas derivative because of the Presley connections, right? And how close you are to Graceland and how associated he was with Las Vegas. Las Vegas is what I almost said, which is actually the name of this little...
I call it Lost Wages.
If you hadn't said it, I might have. And I actually was. I'm not in that headspace right now. I'm thinking about NashVegas too hardly. But yeah, but the last thing to talk about is Austin Olsen, the actor who was hired to portray the would-be musician. He didn't know how to play guitar when he got this, and he only plays one chord the entire song when he is pretending to play guitar, which really just kind of breaks the illusion that little bit.
It really nails the whole, this is all just a fucking dog and pony show, right? Like, it's the this is none of this is actual heartfelt attempt. That's not fair. I'm sure that these guys really love what they do. Don't love what they do.
Yeah, it's just one of those things that to hear the story and then listen to the song, and it will be available in supplemental materials if you're a part of the Discord. And if you're not a part of the Discord, perfect time to join so that you yourself can hear NashVegas and watch the video. Yeah, it's just one of those things that, like, you hear this story and you kind of like, oh, I'm a little bit amped up after hearing the story. How, like, this was the little music video that could. And then you listen to the lyrics and you watch the video and you're like, yeah, no, this was the little video that could. And I guess it did. But, yeah, I don't know if I'm a big fan of of this particular.
So, sorry, everybody. Sorry we even brought it up.
But it's been living rent-free in my mind, and my hope is that by bringing it up to discuss on the Stay Report, I can purge it from my mind.
Oh, let's talk about purging, Devin. I love this. Let's do this. Let's stay on this train.
Okay, Sejohn, I seem to have served you up a beautiful segue. Share with me the madness of two.
I was gonna try and talk about purging pizza from your ass, but it just seems unfair at this point. I was gonna really get into some stuff about Batman this week and talk about Joker and all of this stuff with the movie coming out, because I realized in retrospect, I really expected Joker 2 to like just kind of keep the ball rolling as far as like the success of the first movie and my inability to connect with it. But man, it just feels like kicking a dead horse right now.
Have you seen it? I have to imagine.
No, I didn't even make efforts to see the first. Okay. So this whole idea of where I even wanted to go or what to talk about this week was in expecting it to do really big and all of that. And my big thing being like, I still don't quite understand what audience this is for. Right. And it kind of got me like going through like all this Batman stuff going on right now. I talked last week about the Penguin, still really great show. I was really excited about that, but I don't really have much more to say right now.
I feel bad.
What's up?
I haven't watched it. I was focused on rewatching Joker and then going to see Joker Folie à Deux. I did that.
You picked the wrong timeline, brother.
Apparently.
Penguin, the only other point I would make about Penguin right now, because you haven't watched it, and because, like I said, I actually want to like let it kind of do its thing before we talk about it, I think, is just, all right, right now, current feelings, just to mark them, it feels like watching The Sopranos again, back when I was watching, and I came in late on The Sopranos, so, like, I wasn't even there for, like, the huge fervor of it, but, like, those moments of sitting down and like, taking it, it feels like old school HBO like crime stuff, and it, that just feels great. Anyway, so I started looking at old Batman stuff. I found myself down a rabbit hole, and that was when I discovered the Gotham Pizza promotion that was done along with Little Caesars, Dev, that I was posting about with the group. For anybody interested, you go take a look there. And I was just kind of thinking about all the great stuff that you've always kind of had tied into Batman as far as like the commercialization part of it, the capitalistic like fanboy in me that wants all the bits and pieces and the bobs that come along with these kinds of movies, right? And so like the big thing for me was the Burger King glasses, the like mugs and stuff that had come out for I think both Batman Forever and Batman and Robin, because I'm pretty sure I have a Mr. Freeze one and a Riddler one.
I think Batman Forever was
there's
McDonald's.
Also the toys.
Well, you said Burger King, so I wanted to make sure.
Oh yeah, McDonald's. No, Burger King. There's also a bunch of Burger King shit.
But McDonald's tied their soul to Batman pretty heavily.
Yeah, I mean, but like everybody did, because after that first movie hit so big, and one of the big things that that first movie did, Tim Burton's 89, just to be clear, yeah, is what I'm talking about. What that movie did was, like, in addition to doing really big, it was the end of the 80s and George Lucas had shown everybody how to merchandise the hell out of a thing. And that's what they leaned into with that, right? So I remember I had a Bruce Wayne and a Wayne Manor like set up and stuff that had like the really cool car and a bunch of like the secret passages to get down to the Batcave and stuff, and like I had a bunch of the toys from that stuff too, Batman Returns as well, and so like there was just a whole bunch of that sort of stuff, and I was just like kind of thinking about the fact that with Joker, even Birds of Prey, both Suicide Squad movies, right, which featured Harley Quinn predominantly, had a whole bunch of merchandise with them as well. Tons of good stuff. I was so weirded out by the fact that you have Harley Quinn and Joker together in a movie played by two relatively big stars of our time right now. Like one can argue about where Lady Gaga falls in like the whole movie side of things, but she's made movies, has been recognized for them. We'd be foolish to not talk about that. That's definitely part of her repertoire at this point, right? Oh, yeah, so definitely. Like, there's just this huge thing that's happening in front of us right now. And as much as I am not interested in seeing it, I fully expected the rest of the world to be going nuts, you know? Like, I walked by a Hot Topic and there weren't t-shirts with Lady Gaga's face on them, right, in clown makeup. Like that was weird to me. Like, every other time there has been, especially a Harley Quinn, but anytime you have the Joker and Harley Quinn present in the media for any reason, there's always some huge, like, upswing in merchandise about them and about, like, that specifically. Like, the Arkham games, when the Harley Quinn show came out. Like, there's, like, as I, even Birds of Prey, a movie that, as much as we love it here on this show, we talk about very much was not a successful film and not seen by many people, right? Like, so, like, mm-hmm. But even that still had a push behind it to get stuff. Like, the fact that Joker 2, I'm not even going to try to say the tagline, and it's not because I can't say it, it's because I never remember what subtitles are in English. Why would I remember what it is in French?
Oh, well, it's the madness of two, if you want to say it in English. It's folie.
Yeah, again, I don't even remember them in English, so it's not, that's not going to happen,
yeah,
either.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah, which also is a weird, because that's not really what it's such a while. It's not even worth breaking down, right? Like, the way that this movie has landed so hard on its fucking face that they're not even pushing merchandise for Harley Quinn, the, by DC standards, most merchandisable character. The only character in comics might be bigger than Harley Quinn might be Deadpool, right? But as far as on the DC side of things, if they want to sell anything for the rest of time, they could close up shop on everything and just sell Harley Quinn merchandise and still make bank for a good couple of years.
Yeah, can I like just do it? Can I just like rip the Band-Aid off and talk about this? First of all,
yeah,
this is one of the, I'm dropping it in the Discord right now. This is one of the only toys from the first Joker film, and it's by a third-party company named Felix Toys. There's, like, I think Hot Toys is the only one that did an actual licensed figure.
Oh, did you hear me clicking? I'm furiously clicking to try and find this. Hold on, yeah. Give me a sec.
It's okay. It's in our Discord. It's in the general in our Discord. So, like, that, you talk about the lack of merchandise. The first movie, God, I don't even know. I have to just rip off So, Joker, Folie à Deux, spoilers ahead. If you're somebody who wants to see the movie, even though what the internet is saying is that it's set to have a weekend on par or worse than Morbius is opening weekend, even though it's already done worse than The Marvels and one other one. Like, all of these movies that people point at as, like, this is where fucking movies are right now. This is and where comic
can I just take a,
right now.
Yeah, can please I just do, take yeah. a moment for the obligatory, can we stop shitting on the Marvels for a movie that actually did like 10 times, 20 times better than so many other examples? People keep wanting to point to the Marvels as like the thing to compare it to, I think because of some of the internet talk about that movie.
Yep.
But when you actually look at the numbers of things, including things like the Rotten Tomato scores and stuff, there are plenty of worse comic book movies. There are plenty of worse Marvel cinematic movies, Marvel, like MCU movies to talk about besides that one. But sorry, every time we mention the Marvels and the fact that it's being used as a comparison, which Devin's right, it is being compared, like Joker 2 is being directly compared to the Marvels. I just want to point out how stupid that is. Much like I would say the same thing about Black Adam. People need to stop acting like Black Adam was a failure of a film when WB has openly admitted to lying about how successful it actually was. They underplayed it because they were mad that
The Rock
that basically
was right.
Dwayne Johnson ended up being right. Like, people are so shitty about The Rock and the way that he acted on that movie, but every decision that he made on that film turned out to be the right one. Like, the whole, like, we're not gonna have Shazam, we're gonna have Superman in this. At the end of the fucking day, if you had a choice between Henry Cavill and Zachary Levy being on your set for a day, of course you would fucking push for Henry Cavill instead. Everything we have learned about Zachary Levy over the last 2 years.
Over the last 2 weeks,
The Rock
are you
was
fucking
like,
kidding
yeah, I don't
me?
Want to work with him.
The last 2 weeks where he's like, I was endorsing RFK Jr. And now that he's in the Trump camp, so Zachary Levi. Will came to me. Sorry for this detour, everybody. Will came to me in tears. Like, I can't watch Chuck anymore. And I'm like, I'm sorry? Like, I'm happy to hear that you can't watch Chuck anymore. Like, I mourn the fact that I feel weird watching Tangled, right? Here's what Disney should do. They should hire Henry Cavill to redo all of Zachary Levi's lines and re-release Tangled.
Oh my God, if they finally get around to Tangled 2 and just replace him with Henry Cavill. There is a narrative going around right now with a few different actors out there that we talked about the Jack Black of it all a couple of weeks ago, so I won't reiterate that, but I do want to say that we're also seeing a lot of the same stuff happen with Dwayne Johnson, and a lot of people starting to take issues with him because of some stuff that we heard from WB executives about the way that he behaved on the set of Black Adam, and a bunch of people in that camp, the Snyder Cut camp, wanting to like bring pitchforks and torches to like go after him for ruining the DC like cinematic universe there, whatever the DCEU I think is what they would call
DCEU
it.
DCEU,
like,
yeah.
Like, we now know everything that he did with that movie, the time he took, everything that he pushed. You can love or hate that movie, and people know how we feel about it, but you can love or hate that movie all you want, but nobody could be mad about hearing about the stuff that he was pushing for after everything we've learned since then. About how shitty the WB executives are, about how shitty guys like Zachary Levi are, like everything that we have learned, and the ways that Dwayne Johnson wanted to make his experience on that film a fun one for everyone, and also thought, hey, we're actually doing something here. Like, it pisses me off to hear people still shit on Black Adam too, and all of this. Like, as we sit here in the shadow of Joker 2, to look back and people be like, this all started with Black Adam, and it's like, what the fuck are you talking about?
It weirdly all kind of started with Joker. So I guess I want to put myself into the... I saw a lot of movies this week, and hopefully I can talk about other movies, but this is the centerpiece. This is the turkey at the Thanksgiving dinner that this episode is, right? And the fact of the matter is I still do my Discover Weekly every week on Spotify. I try to do it Monday and Tuesday because it's about an hour of music and I have about a 20-minute commute, so it takes about 2 days to get through the songs that Spotify's algorithm is like, you'll probably like these songs. And one of the songs that was on my Discover Weekly this week was Jackson from Walk the Line. And that was when I was reminded, oh yeah, Joaquin Phoenix played Johnny Cash and sang in that movie. This is going to be awesome, right? Mm-hmm. Putting Joaquin Phoenix into a musical, that can fucking work because, spoilers, it already has. And then you add it with and he's with Lady Gaga, who can fucking sing, right? That's how she became famous. Stephanie Germanotta became Lady Gaga because of her vocal talents. So you put
Anne has proven herself in film musical specifically already with everything that happened with her. Didn't she win an Oscar for
Star Is Born?
Into the Shallows?
For the song, I think so. Star Is Born, yeah. I'm not 100%.
I don't think she won as far as the movie goes and in terms of acting, but I'm pretty sure Into the Shallows, the song for that.
That song is everywhere and it is very popular. I do want to check though, now that you do bring it up, to see what the awards were on that one.
But the point of the matter is, she's no slouch in this realm as well. The movie musical, which is a very particular type of thing, right? Like, if we want to get really down into the nuts and bolts of this whole thing, like, the movie musical is a pretty specific type of thing. And then you want to talk about the concept of the jukebox musical, something that people have some issues with. I'm not going to get into that because I think that's a preference thing more than it is like a like an actual artistry conversation. But like, the jukebox musical, to your point about Joaquin Phoenix, that's exactly what Walk the Line was, right? We just forgive it for being that. For those of us that out there that might take issue with the concept of the jukebox musical, we're all okay with it being a jukebox musical if it's put in the context of the biopic. Historical yeah. like biography, right? Yeah. Right, like look at Ray, right?
but
we're all
no.
okay because like no, no, that would be in that Dreamgirls, right? Isn't that a, like yeah?
Well, Dreamgirls is a musical. That's but technically a biopic musical, right? Like, but it's that one's weird. I hate Dreamgirls. You know that.
There's well, no, but Dreamgirls and what's the one with the four? That's well, just the four guys from the Rat Pack. There, what's
not from the Rat Pack, from the Four Seasons.
Not from the Rat Pack.
Jersey Boys.
Yeah, the Four Seasons. Jersey Boys. Thank you. Yeah, I mean those are technically jukebox musicals because they're using existing music, right?
Dreamgirls, I don't think is using existing music.
Oh, is it not?
I okay. think that that's
I
all
may
original.
Be mistaken on that one.
Yeah. But
I'll
no,
be honest,
but
Dream
yeah.
Girls is a gap in my knowledge, and I shouldn't have brought it up.
That's
no, I mean I'm allowed to talk about
no,
it.
You're allowed
but, like,
to talk about
I
it. I just wanted to make sure
that they were
that
using existing Motown.
While we're talking about like musical biopics, which Jersey Boys most certainly is, Moving Out is most certainly that.
Oh,
though
moving
that's
out.
Never gotten
right,
a movie,
exactly.
but if it ever did, like you, because it's historical and it
I
is.
I could see that. I could see Disney picking up Moving Out and doing it right. Getting like, what's the who's the controversial kid there from Baby Driver and
Ansel Elgort?
Yeah, Ansel Elgort, because he also did West Side Story, right? Like getting Ansel Elgort in to play the Billy Joel character, a already controversial figure played by a controversial actor, seems like it's right up Disney's alley right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, now that the residency at Madison Square Garden is done, I imagine that was probably what was holding up Moving Out, getting a big screen adaptation. That and it just had to wait for its time in the sun to happen. But yeah, so it is like those are different because. You know, it's a biopic, and it's a biopic of a musician. So hearing other versions of the songs, like, that's it. Like, Escape to Margaritaville, that is a jukebox musical. I don't think anybody would forgive, because Jimmy Buffett isn't a character in it. It's just a
well,
bunch of Jimmy Buffett songs.
Jimmy Buffett is, as somebody that loves that show, Jimmy Buffett is confirmed within the show to actually exist in the world.
How do you love that show?
That show is so God. Good. Are you kidding me?
Ow,
that show's a fucking blast. High
I mean, I love Greg
guy.
Garcia.
I
love Mike O'Malley. I saw Escape to Margaritaville at PPAC 2019, and I was like, this is the most miserable experience I've had as a theater audience member.
Oh, no, I was up in the Ann Arbor area of Michigan when I saw it, and we got margaritas before.
Oh, so if you're drunk, it works.
Unexpectedly and unexpectedly after, but I don't know why I didn't expect it. I should have realized that was going to happen. And again, we were also quite altered in many ways,
well, there you
and
go.
We went to go see it. We were at a mini conference, and so, like, it was this great thing where basically a bunch of people, like, kind of off the radar just decided to get places at a hotel, and then we like all met in hotel rooms and like we're giving papers and shit, but then like part of what we wanted to do for the experience was to go to a show, so we go to Escape Margaritaville, and like it was just a fucking blast. I don't know what to tell you, man. I had such a fun time.
I feel like it is 2003 again, and you are SQ, I will just give their initials, being like, you didn't like Finding Nemo, and I'm like, no, I really didn't. She's like, well, you gotta be high. And I'm like, oh, do I?
I'm
Thanks.
Not saying you have to be high. I do believe you need to have a margarita in your belly. That I will stand
I
by.
I don't doubt that. Also, I mean, PPAC is just, I understand that it's a historic theater. It's in need of a bit of an overhaul. And I apologize to everybody who was like, Devin, get to the Joker. All right, so I heard Jackson, and that reminded me, Joaquin Phoenix can fucking sing. So this whole musical thing, like, suddenly I'm excited about it, right? And they have mm-hmm. already confirmed yep. that any of the singing is sort of hyper-realistic dream sequence stuff. So I can believe Arthur Fleck, who is just this miserable character in the first movie, in like a fantasy world, is going to get to have the big boisterous voice, right? Because it's fantasy. It's him feeling at his best. So the first thing I have to say about Joker Folie à Deux is, yeah, there's some scenes where they sing, but to call it a musical is a misrepresentation. If you're somebody who doesn't want to see Joker Folie à Deux because it is a fucking musical, don't let that bother you. Also, I'm going to be calling it Joker Deux from now on. I don't want to say the Folie à Deux every time.
But there's so much of a push to talk about the inspiration from, like, the MGM musicals. Is that actually there?
I mean, they're definitely there. Like, the first movie has a bunch of MGM musicals, right? That's Entertainment is featured in Joker Deux. But, the Slap That Bass.
The Dancing
on
the Stairs, I mean, is pretty.
Is that. But Slap That Bass is played. Like, he watches the Slap That Bass scene. That's when he accidentally fires the gun. He's like, I'm watching a war movie. Also, I rewatch Joker, so I have more knowledge about the movie Joker, because I wasn't half asleep after driving 8 hours home when I saw it. I really liked Joker watching it the second time, completely alone and in preparation of the second movie. And I have to say, I feel like the second movie, as much as there is this fervor out there that Todd Phillips did not want to make the movie, did not want to make a sequel to Joker, but they offered him a fuck ton of money, so he said, sure, I'll do it. But then he created a movie that would make sure they wouldn't say we want a Joker 3, right? That's the theory that's out there that is conspiratorial at best, but watching the first...
No, not that Todd Phillips doesn't have the ability to make a sequel, which we already know people already feel. And this is coming from somebody that enjoys the Hangover trilogy.
I love the Hangover 2. I think it's great.
Right, but like the... Right, but we would be foolish to not deny that the common consensus about Todd Phillips' trilogy, the Hangover trilogy, like that 2 and 3 were considered by most to be unnecessary, right? Like, and now here we are again, watching the same thing happen, history repeat itself, and Todd Phillips gets to walk away with $300 and some odd million was the number I had heard.
That's crazy, because the budget for the film was $200 million, so if
what I heard was probably
bullshit. Because if he got paid $100 million than the budget for this film... that'd be crazy.
Well, maybe that might have been estimates based off of he might have gotten some of the back end point stuff.
Right.
And considering that the first one made over $1 billion, that actually wouldn't be that crazy of an estimate, right? Depending on what his numbers were there.
And again, but I don't think it's going to get there.
Are you kidding me? I'll be surprised if it passes $60 million.
Yeah. But the best way to watch Joker do is immediately following Joker. I have to put that out there because it is so closely tied to what happened in the first movie. I mean, like, beats and moments and physicality from characters and actual characters and events that, like, having it as fresh as it could be in my mind before going into the second movie, I appreciated the second movie more. So I would more believe that Todd Phillips is like, oh, you guys love this movie? So I'm going to put all this stuff into it and prove you don't remember the movie, right? I almost feel like he's pranking them. Maybe Todd Phillips is the Joker now. Sejohn, I have to ask you a question because I learned a new bit of slang. And this is our 403rd episode of the Say Report. And the slang I learned this weekend is a 304. Do you know what a 304 is?
I mean, it sounds like it's referencing like a police number, like a police call number.
Nope. So 304, sometimes referred to as a 304 girl. Does that help you at all?
A 304 girl? So now I'm just thinking like measurements.
Yeah, okay. So like these are the thoughts. I'm like, what the fuck is a 304? So I went to Urban Dictionary, and it turns out it is one of the most juvenile fucking things ever. The fact that it is slang that currently exists totally tracks with things like Ohio and Skibidi and all of that, right? 304 is a hoe. Because if you type 304 into a calculator and turn it over, it looks like the word ho. I wish I were kidding. But one of the complaints I kept seeing levied against Joker Deux is that he gets played by a 304. And that, when I left the theater, was my biggest fucking fear. Right? So much of Arthur Fleck in the first movie is he's an incel. All right? All band-aids are ripped off. I'm going raw here. He is portrayed as an incel, right? His imaginary relationship with Zazie Beetz, Sophie Drummond, like the fact that he's incel coded, and that's what leads him to become the Joker. In the second movie, he finds Harley Quinzel, who is called Lee the whole movie, except for one moment where his lawyer is like, Oh, Lee, do you mean Harley Quinzel? And then she reads off all these things because, as it turns out, what she did was voluntarily admit herself into Arkham Asylum so that she could meet the Joker. She could
get close to him.
So that she could do all this stuff. She does have a psychology background. Her parents are not dead. These are huge spoilers for the film. If you give a shit about the movie,
I've heard they're huge. Okay, to be clear and correct, and this is something I actually want you to clarify for me. I've heard that these are spoilers, but they're spoilers that then get revealed like 40 minutes in to a 2-hour and some odd minute movie.
It's right near the end of the film, actually.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay, so okay, it's okay. So.
It's. I mean,
I had heard that this became pretty obvious pretty early on. Maybe this was people trying to act smarter than they are online. You know, like,
no, it's
oh,
one
I,
of those
I
situations
the
where.
But anyway, okay.
It's one of those situations where, when it's confirmed, you're like, yeah, okay, that makes sense. Like, it's like, so it's one of those where I could see people like, I saw it coming, and it's like, I thought it was actually interesting to not have her have this background, right? To actually have her
the
be
whole
this,
conversation. Yeah, the whole conversation we had last week about the Penguin versus the first Joker movie and the problems that I have with the ways that they change it, some of the stuff that they were talking about with Harley's being changed, because, like you said, we're in spoiler territory at this point.
Yes.
But, like, the choices that they make in the early parts of the movie for them to change Harley's background didn't seem so offensive to me. Because, like, those aren't the important parts of Harley, I guess, for me as a fan. This is revealing the truth of the whole matter about all of it, right? Is like, because those aren't things that I consider important, if you want to change them, fine, right? Other people might consider them important and be shitty about it, but not me.
Well, so I listened
so,
to...
So, like, the stuff that they talked about changing with her, I thought, like you said, was somewhat interesting and not so key to her character that I felt it was important that they needed to be there.
Right. I mean, I listened to our episode where we talked about the first Joker film. When I think you might not have seen it yet. It was the one after Speed Gaming Live where I had driven home and I saw...
Either I hadn't seen it or I had done the thing where I watched the first hour of it and turned it off because I just... I could not... I still to this day have not been able to finish that movie. Anybody
out
there?
Wow, that's... Like, okay. Like... So, like, do you see him become the Joker? Because, like, that doesn't happen until, like, the end of the movie.
Yeah, no, I have since then seen and bits also, and pieces of it because it's one of those movies that you like couldn't avoid, right? Between like scenes online, memes online, and like also being at people's houses while they were watching it and stuff. Like, I think I was home when mom and dad watched it, that kind of thing. So like, I have seen the movie, but as far as me like sitting down and paying attention to it was like the first like half of that movie. So.
No, that's fair. I mean, I get it. We watch stuff very differently. I have to commit if I'm committing to a movie. The only one I've never done that with is American Beauty, and I might have made it.
Normally you're right, but Joker didn't get that for me.
That's fine. I understand it. And again, right? Like, time is so fucking precious. Don't waste it on something you're not enjoying, right? And so often we talk about find something to enjoy. Like, as it upsets me that you haven't watched Wonder Woman 1984, but only because I watched it twice, the second viewing to talk about it on the show, and then you were like, yeah, I just couldn't do it. But I subjected myself to it twice.
Maybe that's what I'll get you for Christmas this year. Maybe I'll watch it and we can talk about it.
Then I'd have to watch it a third time. And then, no, you wouldn't have watched it. I'm not falling for your tricks, Sejohn. I have seen the face of the devil, and it is thine. But yes, so yeah, all that stuff. Because Gotham, whatever, Cape Crusader, is that the one that was on Amazon? The new animated one? Have you watched all of that? Have you seen the Harley episode of that series?
Oh, yeah, yes. Yeah. I've watched it all multiple times.
Oh, good, 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 good. So good. I just wanted to make sure. I love it. I absolutely love it. But Harley existing without the Joker was a really cool change. I really liked that. So then after hearing us talk about, like, the Joker is such a malleable character that, like, if this is what they want to do with him in the first movie, I'm okay with that. So then, like, if that's going to be Todd Phillips' approach to these characters, which, like, isn't that the nature of adaptation? Isn't that the nature of Elseworlds, which this was supposedly the first DC Elseworlds film? Like, straight up, we are admitting this is a different universe, so don't get pissy if stuff is different here. Like, an idea of Harley not being some psychologist who falls in love with her patient and then gives everything up to become his fucking, you know, sidekick, right?
Right.
Like, I love, like, they're both, and especially the title, right, Folie à Deux, is in English The Madness of Two, which is a phenomenon of two people's, like, not to steal from Deadpool, but crazy matching each other, right? It's like their craziness enables each other and makes them crazier. So, like, the idea of her being somebody who is psychotic, has lost her father, set fire to their building, right? And then the mother had her committed because of it. And then her finding the Joker in there, and rather than that being a deterrent, being a catalyst and enabling moment for her. That's interesting. So when it's all stolen away by Catherine Keener playing the Joker's lawyer, being like, yeah, she fucking lied to you. Like, none of that was true. She's playing you. And it's just like, he's like, no, you're lying, you're lying, you're lying. All I can think of is how the incel movement has grown to that them talking so much about, like, all women want to do is fuck you over. Everything a woman says is a lie, right?
Yeah,
like that.
This becomes like a confirming moment in that movie, right? Like,
and that is gross. Like, that happened, and I'm like, great. Like, that if this finds the same audience the first one did, and at the time I thought it very well could. What a gross moment of confirmation for, like, their whole movement. Is that this Harley Quinn is not, you know, someone who actually loves him, but really all she tried to do was defraud him so that she could make him what she wanted him to be. And they fuck, like, she sneaks into his solitary confinement cell. She gets the help from the guards and they have sex. And then she's holding the fact that she's pregnant over him, like, half of the movie. And, like, he's excited to have this home, like, life with her and a family. And, like, and then that's a lie, too, which is just another one of, like, Jesus fucking Christ. Todd, please stop for your fan base confirming all of the things that they believe. Like, this can't happen. Because you do this and it's going to have negative connotations. And the world's already fucked up. Right? Like, all they need is a movie to be like, see, Hollywood fucking gets it.
$1 billion movie, right? Like, yeah. God forbid that it becomes that. But it's, like I said before, I don't think it's going
to be the sequel to $1 billion movie. Like, that's it.
Well, yeah, that's how it's going to live now, right? Yeah. But the risk at the time being it could have been the next $1 billion movie and having it have all this shit in it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think, though, I love the. Once again, reaffirmation that if you make a movie that, like, people can act like these movies aren't politically charged, but they so are. Like, they're a huge part of these movies. Like, there's just that whole, like, I hate politics in my games. Like, why aren't there less politics, like, in Fallout? And it's like, well, you're not paying fucking attention. Like, I love that when the politics in a movie, when they try and lean into this kind of shit and they just fall on their face. This is like watching Kevin Sorbo go out and make another God is Dead film. Like, yeah, keep pumping them out. keep trying. They ain't gonna land.
Do you mean God's not dead? Or did he do ones that God is dead? Because that
Whatever,
is interesting
yeah.
to me. God's not dead. Those movies are kind of weird to me. I've only ever seen the trailers. But imagine Kevin Sorbo doing God is Dead movies. That would not really jive with his whole Republican thing. But yeah, so that happens in this whole thing. And then at the end, right, like he's full Joker, he's representing himself in his trial, and his closing statements are like kind of brutal. Like he's like taking shots at the guards in Gotham and Arkham and all this other fucking shit. And like, Jesus fucking Christ. So then they rape him. They shower rape him. The guards at Arkham Asylum. And then he's back in court and he's like, I'm done. Like, I don't want to be part of this anymore. I'm not the Joker. I'm Arthur Fleck. I killed 6 people. And he just has this whole moment of like, I'm no longer the Joker. That's his closing statement. His final statement when he's like in Joker mode, he's like, those fat fucking guards over at Arkham Asylum don't know what the fuck they're doing. The inmates are running it. And then there are consequences for his actions, which you don't see consequences for the action of the Joker, right? His consequences are Batman punches him in the face. But then, you know, there's that whole Batman so fucking broken that he can't put an end to this guy. Like, I remember that issue that happened in college where it was confirmed that the Joker was responsible for 1,000,000 murders. Like, do you remember that whole thing? And then it's like, so like Batman,
where like Batman's like put on trial and they're like, why have you not killed the Joker? And like the confirmation comes out with like what he's done, right?
Yeah. How many casualties can be directly linked to his actions? And it's like, I understand that you want to believe in rehabilitation and that you don't want to take a life, but like, at what point is something so dangerous that it needs to be dealt with, essentially, mm-hmm. is the question there, right? So, like, he has consequences. He calls out these guards, and by all accounts, like, they're corrupt, right? If he tells them a joke, they'll give him a cigarette. They give him, like, extra little treats, right? Because he's a famous prisoner. And not is he even a prisoner? He's in Arkham Asylum. He's not in like a correctional facility, right? He's in a state mental hospital. So
like this has been the problem with both of these movies for me, is that like they go out of their way to show that the Joker is not wrong. And it's just like, no, at some point you need to show that he has gone way too far and is completely wrong. Like, that's the thing about the Joker, is at some point, like, giving him moralistic, defined reasons why he is the way he is kind of breaks the whole I'm so crazy thing, right? Like, he needs to do something that, even though it's more beneficial to him to behave himself, he doesn't, because that he's chaos, right? By grounding the things that he's doing in the reality that Gotham is so corrupt that like they deserve it, essentially, you're breaking the whole like chaotic nature of the Joker.
Gotham confirmed to just be New York City, because his case file is GC blah 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 blah. But at the end, when they read the jury, the city of New York versus Arthur Fleck in first degree murder of Franklin Morris, we the jury find him guilty. Like, they ground it in the fact that it's New York, not Gotham, which was an interesting choice, I will say that. But yeah, so also he's found guilty of the murder of Murray, of Frank Murray or whatever, Robert De Niro from the first movie. Spoilers, he kills him, Sejohn. I don't know if you know that because you haven't seen the movie. But
what happens at the end of that movie?
He gets what he deserves.
Yeah.
So that one is confirmed. He confesses to killing his mother, even though he does not have, no one knows about that. He's on trial for the murder of 5 people. He's charged with second degree murder of the guy who gives him the gun, right? The other clown who then comes to his apartment and is kind of threatening, and he kills him. And then he lets the little person, Gary, go, 'cause he's like, you were the only one who was ever nice to me, sort of thing. So he's charged with second degree murder there, which is correct, right? That guy was there. He brought him to a passionate moment to kill, right? It was not cold-blooded. It was not premeditated. It was a killing of passion and of circumstance. And then with the 3 guys on the subway, he's also found guilty. And, like, rewatching the first movie, I'm like, that's such self-defense in that moment. Three people who are, like, 30 years younger than him start beating him on a subway car. And, like, not fun beating, like, kicking him and would, like, obviously kill him if they had the opportunity. So him pulling out a gun and defending himself, essentially what makes the Joker, right? His origin moment, which is finally standing up to the bullies in his life. Like, I'm not surprised that he was found guilty, but, like, it just kind of felt weird that, like, they couldn't have done something different there. If that makes any sense.
No, because again, these movies have to reaffirm this idea that actually the Joker's been right the whole time. like that's the thing, right? Is like, and like, you know, people are going to point out a million ways in which the movies try and show you, no, he's not. But like, then it needs to do that the whole fucking way.
And
by
even
giving him any rope, by saying at any point he actually had a moral standing in what he did, you've completely ruined the concept of the Joker.
Yeah. The second viewing of the first movie, I'm like, yeah, so this killing of these three guys, at least the first two, justified. Following the third guy and making sure that he died too, that one might be difficult to convince a jury that it was self-defense. But like, Catherine Keener's whole thing that he was not competent, that he has a split personality, that the Joker personality was in control, so Arthur Fleck is innocent. It is this other personality that needs to be held accountable. So, like, he shouldn't be killed. He should try to be rehabilitated. Like, Catherine Keener's my new favorite Batman. I just have to make that argument. And again, that's such an absurd argument. It's just said for comedy. I know that she's not actually that. There are two moments where he kisses her, and those are, like, the big, like, holy shit moments to me in this film. Because, like, she's being nice to him, and he just, like, pecks her on the lips, and she freaks out. And I'm like, that was more salacious and meaningful for, like, this Joker-esque character than anything that he did with Lady Gaga's version of Harley Quinn. Yeah. Like, and I liked her Harley Quinn until the reveal that she's just fucking lying to him, right? And the idea of, like, somehow she's also so psychotic that, like, when he's no longer what she believes him to be as the Joker, she's like, go fucking die in a corner. Like, but she, like, buys his old apartment so that when he gets out of jail, they can live there together. And, I mean, you keep calling it a jukebox musical. It's really a movie musical. Because they're all old songs from old MGM stuff. Like you pointed out. But it's not like they're fucking sitting there, like, singing Royals, right? They're singing, we're gonna build a mountain. And it's like, oh, okay. Like, that's a song I haven't heard in, like, 30 years. Like, it's not popular stuff. Like, I think the idea of the jukebox musical is you're taking songs that are currently popular and then putting them into a musical because then it's, like, instant profit. Like,
these are not currently popular is necessarily true. Look at the ABBA jukebox musical. It's not like those songs were, like, number one on the charts when they made Mamma Mia, right?
Right.
But I mean, like, that's just because they chose unpopular songs doesn't mean that it doesn't fit the concept of, which is, it's pre-existing music that they are putting into this to suit the scene rather than writing for it, right? Which call it whatever you want. That is the style of musical that it is, right?
Yeah, I don't know. Like, that, you're right. It is the style, but it just, I wanted it to be, like, fun music. Like, even, like, from, like, old movie musicals, it's, like, it's none of the fun songs, or the performances are not very fun. It's just like, oh, okay, like, merrily we roll along.
But that's because it's a musical done with the Joker, Devin. It's the Joker. It's a little twisted.
Yeah, I don't know. That's entertainment, I guess. Gonna build a mountain! I don't know. It was, but yeah, so people are mad about it because at the end, Joker is shanked by another prisoner. They do, like, this really interesting thing of, like, he has little acolytes of, like, people, like, oh, this guy could become the Joker, right? Like, because the Joker in this is an idea. It's not one person. Fuck, at his trial, after they read the guilty verdict, there's an explosion of the courthouse. The side of the courthouse explodes. And you see Harvey Dent, and he's, like, down there, and you're like, oh, is this what he becomes Two-Faced? Because, like, only one side of his face is all bloodied from this explosion. And that's where Arthur, like, runs out into the street. And in the street is another guy dressed as his Joker. And it's just like, whoa, like, that was a cool, like, visual moment. And then that Joker grabs him, throws him into a car, and they're like, yeah, we had to get you out of there, man, because, like, you mean something, right? We're not going to let them martyr you and just shove you and kill you. Like, you need to stay alive so the movement stays alive. And, like, okay, but, like, aren't you kind of the Joker now? You just look like me as the Joker. No one would think that it's not Arthur Fleck if you were out there doing stuff, other than the fact that they saw him die. But, like, can you don't get... It just... It's so weird. He gets killed at the end. Like, this inmate who's been watching him the whole time, who, like, looks a little crazy, says, I have a joke for you. A psychotic, you know, what can I get you if you're paying? All right, I'll get you exactly what you deserve. And he shakes him in the belly, and he bleeds out. And as he's dying, the guy in the background gives himself, like, the scars from Heath Ledger's Joker. Like, he cuts his cheeks with the same shiv. And, like, that's the end of the movie. So, like, Todd Phillips' Joker, Arthur Fleck, is dead. And I'm sorry to do these spoilers, but, like, that's how the movie ends. And I have to get this movie off my chest because it's bothering me. Like, I'm not upset that I saw it, but it's just one of these situations where, like, I kind of enjoyed the film. The parts of the film I didn't enjoy are the parts that I felt could be misinterpreted by what would have been the audience based on who reacted to the first movie, right?
Yeah.
It's like them getting confirmation that, like, oh, all women want to do is lie to you and take away your agency. And that's, like, there's two scenes where that's what fucking Harley does, right? And then when he won't be exactly what she wants to be, she dumps him, right? Like, those type of people who really connected with the first movie, and we saw it. I'm not making that up, right? Look at the articles from when that film came out, and, like, he's an incel hero and all these other things that they attributed to the Arthur Fleck Joker. And that's all it is. Yeah. Like, it's this version of the Joker is that, right? I never thought Mark Hamill's Joker from the animated series was a virgin, but, like, Arthur Fleck, yeah, I don't think that he's ever had sex. And that's, he's made fun of about that. And then he finally gets to have sex with Harley Quinn. And just like Ferris said about Cameron, he's going to marry the first girl that sleeps with him because she'll have given him the one thing that he has convinced himself he needs to be happy. Right? There's a little bit of incel stuff in Ferris Bueller as well. Come to find out. I mean, like, I've
well, he's
it,
calling but, it out. He's not. He's, yeah. To be fair, the movie is making it a point to point out how that's unhealthy.
Right. But I mean, but confirmation is confirmation sometimes, which is just a sad thing.
We can't not ever not.
No,
talk
but,
about
but if you don't talk though, about it, then things don't get brought up. I agree.
Right.
But yeah. So I just made that connection though. In this moment.
Me put it this way. There's many other problems to talk about with Ferris Bueller's Day Off before you get to some of the weird incel stuff going on with Cameron that the movie itself even calls out.
Yes. But yeah, so the Joker, so people are probably not going to like Joker 2, even if they see it. I don't think people are going to, I would say if, like, I liked the first movie after watching it and, like, having a full, like, full concentration of it. And I'm like, this is saying some interesting stuff. I am now firmly convinced that Thomas Wayne is definitely his father, as fucked up as that is, because he is definitely in his 40s. Because you haven't worked for him for 30 years, but, like, she was fired after she was committed, and he was 8 years old at that time. So he's, like, probably 38, if not 40, in this movie. So in the first movie, so then 2 years later, he's, like, a 40-year-old man at this whole time in his life. And Joaquin Phoenix is, what, he's 50 in real life? We did that last week, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's, like, so even if he's 50, like, Thomas Wayne, when he was screwing the maid, he had to have been a teenager, right? Like, she's very young in the flashback to when they're like, you adopted your son. We have the paperwork right here. No, that's a lie. That's a lie so that they can say that it's not his baby, but that's not the truth. And it's just like, oh, this is the truth, right? Like, that whole thing. But, like, Batman, Bruce Wayne doesn't show up again in the movie, right? Baby Bruce Wayne isn't in Joker 2. It's all about the Joker, and it's all about, like, taking it away from him. And
they don't talk about Thomas Wayne at all in this one, do they?
No, not at all. They talk about Mayor Thorndike, which made me happy. I'm like, okay, good. Yeah, like, that's a name I know.
Like even they recognize that particular storyline was a bridge too far.
Yeah. And it's still like that's the part, because the first movie, like with the garbage strike and Thomas Wayne saying that poor people are clowns. So like, that's why clowns become the face of the fucking Occupy Wall Street movement in fucking the Joker, the first Joker film. Right? Like, it all tracks why that happens. Right? The scariest thing about the first Joker is that it's not too far off from what the world was like in 2019. Right? And then everything that fucking happened with the COVID and the protests and everything there. Like, we were ready to boil over. And weirdly, like, Todd Phillips put that into a movie, like, that released October of 2019, before the whole world went crazy anyway. Sorry, it's just like, but like, watching it, I'm like, yeah, there's some good stuff in here. There's some interesting things in there. There's some incredible performances. And there are still some incredible performances in Joker 2. I just wish that, I don't know. Like, I don't want the people who would see that movie and then go off crowing about how, like, Harley fucking screwed him, man, right? Like, I'm glad that those people aren't going to happen, because they're not going to like this movie. They're not going to like that the Joker was raped by guards, and that is basically what forced him to not want to be the Joker anymore. Right? I guess that was a punchline too far for him.
Fucking weird. That's such a weird plot point. I don't even know what to say about it right now.
It's fine.
The use of rape as a tool in storytelling is already super, like,
cringy, like, not my bag. Gross, like, disgusting.
It's cringy in general, and for me in particular, it's just like a pretty big no-go. Like, I just don't. It is overused and often unnecessary, but I don't know. Without having seen the movie, I don't want to start. I don't want to go too deep into its use here, but it's just like, what a cheap way to, like, move the story along.
Like, it was going at this nice build, and then that happened, and then, like, oh, I guess there's just fucking nothing now. And then the explosion happened, and I'm like, oh, that's interesting. And then being face-to-face with what he has wrought by being the Joker, and like, no, I don't fucking want this. So he runs away from that, too. And then Harley fucking tells him everything, and, like, he just gets arrested again. Like, he doesn't fight for it, because he's got nothing left to live for. And then he dies. Okay, that's the movie, I guess. But, like, as a full piece, right? Like, if you watched it as one uninterrupted four-hour thing, I think it might be interesting. What I want to see, first of all, I do hope that Me and My Shadow, the Merry Melodies-style Joker animated, like, opening of the film is available everywhere. I recommend anybody watch that. It is classic Looney Tunes, Merry Melodies style animation. The plot is very interesting, with this idea of the Joker being overshadowed by his actual shadow. And, like, this idea of, you know, what the movement of the Joker versus the person that is the Joker is. Like, there's some interesting stuff in that little 2-minute fucking animation that is beautifully animated. And also, sorry, I hope that the fake TV movie that was made about the events of the first film, I hope that that somehow exists in some way, shape, or form. Because they keep talking about, did you see the TV movie? Which, like, so I did read one theory that the whole movie is, like, kind of punishing those people who were fans of the first film.
Yeah.
So, like, the idea that the TV movie they're talking about is that first film that we saw. And so all these people who are, like, obsessed with it and, like, what eventually happens to them or what is wrought because of it, Like, that one I could almost try. Todd Phillips didn't want to make this movie, right? That became abundantly clear to me when I rewatched Joker, and it ends with the end. He was done. He was done with the character. But again, right. Money is a powerful fucking tool. All right. So that's the Joker. Do you want to sober up with some other stuff, Sejohn? What did you do this week?
I mean, we've gotten into our hollow watching for the year. We decided to go back and start with Wallace and Gromit: Curse of the Were-Rabbit because the new Wallace and Gromit's going to be coming out later this year. And so we were kind of in a Wallace and Gromit move, and that was a good way to start our Halloween movies this year. But man, that movie's a blast. I forgot how much fun that movie is.
It really is a good time. I saw it with something else. I don't think I saw it alone. And the whole night has just kind of become one big thing. But it is super charming. It's very interesting. That's the first technically computer-like assisted animation of Wallace and Gromit, right?
Like, yes. So Aardman, who does the Wallace and Gromit films, had teamed up with DreamWorks about 10 years previously to do a fully digital animated movie in Flushed Away, which is a wild movie. I still think holds up, but definitely suffers from the early DreamWorks not having the best graphics looking forward. You know, like, people talk about watching Toy Story now and like going back to the original Toy Story and how rough that one looks, but like have to kind of come to terms with the fact with what things looked like at the time. But they do something really interesting in the Disney movies, and Nintendo gets away with this too, where because they're not pushing for a hugely realistic style in any fashion, they're able to kind of get away with some things that stand the test of time a little bit better, right? The problem with Flushed Away, specifically, and I will focus on that one specifically, is that because it's trying to emulate actual claymation figures that have, like, we've seen, maybe we haven't seen these exact people or characters in the world before, but we've seen these style of figures before, because it's trying to capture something so real, it just looks so rough. And I don't know if that's because I have the comparison in my mind or if there's something else going on, but like Flushed Away is a little hard to watch in a couple of scenes because of the animation. But that one was fully digital, right? And that one flops. Not flops, but that one does not land as hard as it probably could have, should have. I think it's a totally fun movie and I would encourage people to watch it, but it's not considered that huge in the grand scheme of things, which is wild because, I mean, Aardman doing a fully CGI movie after their entire history of physical, like, claymation animation, like, to move to that, I think should be talked about more. But when that doesn't work, they end up going back to just doing a lot of hand stuff and they really push themselves. But you're right, when we get to Curse of the Were-Rabbit, that's when we finally see them kind of coming back to CGI and using it more as CGI assisted animation as opposed to full CGI animation. So like things like you could totally tell in the opening credits when the title of the movie changes in some way, you're like, okay, that's CGI, but then 2 seconds later you're looking at thumbprints in Wallace's face. So it's kind of hard to detect when one steps in over the other.
It's interesting that you mentioned the thumbprints on Wallace's face because I remember, I don't know where I watched it, but them talking about the thing we're most proud about in the computer-generated part of this animation is that we've been able to emulate when we leave a thumbprint in the in the clay.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
like,
it's
that's,
something that I've also noticed in a lot of claymation video games is that they've really gone out of their way to make sure they leave behind the imperfections. What is that line from Oliver Platt in Bicentennial Man? Like, it's perfection is about the imperfections or something like that.
Yes. Thank you for a Bicentennial Man reference. It's what really makes the Say Report different from any other podcast you're going to listen to, except for a Bicentennial Man Minute where they watch in a minute at a time. I apologize for this detour. No, that's good. I'm glad. We were going to start hollow watching, but sickness coming to the house threw a lot off. Like, I really wanted to watch the Child's Play series from Child's Play through to Curse of Chucky, I believe is the last one, or it might be Cult of Chucky. The titles are too similar for the last two Chucky films.
Is that include the Mark Hamill Child's Play remake from a couple of years ago?
No. I wouldn't have watched that one as part of it. I mean, I would have watched it eventually, but my hope was to do the original three Child's Play films, Bride of Chucky, Seed of Chucky, Curse of Chucky, Cult of Chucky. Those seven. We were going to do one a night, and then, you know, I was hoping to do the Chucky series that got canceled last Saturday, right after three seasons. And that was my whole thing, is that I wanted to watch those movies because I'd have the time to do it. So in terms of Halloween movies, I've watched a lot of Christmas specials.
Yeah.
Is what I have to just be honest with. I've been watching Life with Louie on YouTube. I have like four episodes left of it. And, you know, the 10th episode of season three is a Christmas episode. So I got to watch that. I just watched, like, we started New Girl as just like a comfort show. And so I watched a Thanksgiving episode and the Bells episode, which isn't technically a Christmas episode, but it kind of feels like one a little bit because they're playing freaking hand bells. And that just sounds like Christmas to me. I've been watching Anger Management, the show. Hate the movie. Still love the show. And two Christmas episodes are in that. 100 episodes of that crazy Charlie Sheen series. That, like, I hate how much I enjoy the show. I'm just going to be honest with you. But, like, a lot of people cut their teeth on that series just because they were trying to shoot 90 episodes as fast as humanly possible.
Yeah, right. Like, right. Quick before they cut us off.
Yep. And it's so, I don't know. I liked Charlie Sheen before everything. So, like, it's fun watching him, but it's fun watching his actual father play his father in it. And they just get all these people who, like, we know now in, like, early roles. And it's an interesting view back. And I don't know. So I've been doing that. A lot of Christmas there. And then, again, I watched more movies besides the Joker duology that I got to take in. I saw Transformers 1 because, God, I want Transformers 1 to succeed. I think I'm doing a big spoiler episode with Zach from That Toy Makes Me Happy and our friend Sean, who does a bunch of Pokemon videos. I don't know what he calls his Pokemon videos. So once that happens, I'll make sure everybody can know about it because I have really heavy thoughts about Transformers 1. Can I share one of them with you? Are you going to see Transformers 1 at all, Sejohn? Or can I offer a spoiler there?
I would like to see Transformers 1. I think we need to, before we go too far, I think we need to talk a little bit about exactly what Transformers 1 is, because I have realized more often than not when I talk about Transformers 1, people just think it's a, like, another Michael Bay movie.
Well, he is a producer on it.
Yeah, so sure. He's going to be a producer in perpetuity because he's got his name in the basket. Right. But, like, it is.
But
so,
it's not that.
So talk to me about it, because it's not that, right?
So Transformers 1 is a fully animated film. It is like the CGI sort of graphics. It's not hand-drawn like the 1986 Transformers, the movie. And it is an origin of such of how Orion Pax became Optimus Prime and the people who were around him and what Cybertron was like before. I mean, this is a movie that takes place, you know, so it's like a Godzilla Minus One or a Batman Begins or like Batman Year Zero, right? Where you get to see the world before the world that we're very familiar with.
Right, because there's a lot of timeline stuff to talk about in that regard too. But the biggest thing is for me is that the animation, while it is full CGI, it is not straight up the animation for the Michael Bay movies though. Because definitely a softness and a change to a lot of the characters that I really like.
They look like Transformers. They don't look like screaming metal spikes, right?
Yeah,
like
no,
Michael
there's
Bay.
There's a style to this one that I really adore.
Michael Bay, for all that he has given us, he's really into realism. Those are the words I just said to describe Michael Bay. So he wanted it to be realistic that, like, Optimus Prime is a robot that comes from a truck. Ditto with, like, the Decepticons, and he makes them all, like, creepy and angular and sharp. Like, any Transformer in a Michael Bay movie looks like if you touch it, Your finger's going to start bleeding immediately.
And you're going to get tetanus.
You're going to get
tetanus. Like, in addition to being sharp, they're also, like, grimy.
Yeah. And I mean, that's a style choice. And I don't hate that style choice for his films, right? Because it's very much what he's trying to do. Like, I also wouldn't have hated, I've read the Blue Door script. If the Ninja Turtles were from an alien race in his Ninja Turtle movie, a movie that I think most people have just forgotten about, right? Like, it just feels that way.
Not that sequel, though.
No, I would not have hated it. Because it's Michael Bay. It's just what he does, right? Yeah. Like, it doesn't bother me. His stuff is
also, it's not like aliens
don't
exist in the comic. Like, the way people got weird about the introduction of aliens to the Turtles lore in that idea, and it's just like, do you guys not read anything or watch the show, or like, what are you talking about? Like, aliens have been part and parcel of this.
I mean, the ooze is chemical waste runoff from the Utroms, who are aliens that were marooned on Earth. Right? That's Mirage. Volume 1, Issue 4, that they find out where they came from, right? Secret of the Ooze. It was very much supposed to be that the Professor, whatever his name, Professor Perry, was an Utrom in disguise. But they were afraid that kids would think it was Krang. And Krang's a bad guy. Professor Perry's not a bad guy. Idiots. Not the producers on that movie, not the kids who would make the mistake. I mean, even in the 1987 series, the ooze comes from Dimension X. It is always alien in origin.
Right.
I don't know why that was such a bother to people. The bother to people, to me, was the fact that, like, Shredder was a mutant porcupine alien.
That would be a little bit.
That was a bit of a stretch there, right? But, you know, like, whatever. So it's like that stuff. But Transformers 1, yeah, they are very, they look very toyetic, right? They're bright colors. They are softer edges. They're rounded instead of, like, being hyper-angular. But it is very much a world before there has ever been an Autobot or a Decepticon, right? They are living in a Cybertron that is still recovering from the war against the Quintessons. And it is super interesting, this film. And I have this...
This is at the point in the history when they're kind of like on the verge of a possible utopia, right? Like, if they could just keep their shit together, or is this like...
Well, I mean, that's a pretty big plot point of the film, Sejohn. Is the fact that, like, so Energon only flows when the matrix of leadership is there. So there is no Energon flowing on the planet of Cybertron in this movie. So they have to mine for it. But aside from the fact that they have to mine to like keep people safe, the Cogless, which are the people who cannot transform, they live pretty much. I mean, it's kind of like the bread and circus that we know of in like Greek and Roman times.
Right.
So, like, their lives are not bad. Most people are pretty happy with how the world is, despite the fact that, you know, they were ravaged by war. There's a great war hero who is now their leader. But then there is something a little sinister going on behind the scenes, which is what the plot of the movie is.
Right. Yeah. Just to set up what we're talking about with Transformers 1, like, there's a lot of really interesting stuff story-wise. Stylistically, it's something new and I think a little bit more easy to look at personally, enjoyable to look at even. Like, there's a lot of really good stuff about this. On top of all of that, the story that I understand zeitgeist-wise about this film is that it's a pretty fucking badass film, but it just, nobody saw it, so it just kind of died in theaters.
Yeah, they didn't really give it any sort of marketing push or anything like that. The biggest marketing push comes from people who've seen the movie, like, hey, instead of going to see Joker Folie à Deux this weekend, go see Transformers 1. You think that there's nothing worth seeing at the theaters? Why not go see Transformers 1? Oh, you don't want to support, like, Zachary Levi and Harold and the Purple Crayon? Go see Transformers 1. And I hope that it finds the type of success that Hasbro cares about. Because even they have said about the Michael Bay movies, when they started to do not as well as the first movie did, like, the other intangibles about those films, like the toy line that came along with it and how well that sold, is why they kept making movies until it was no longer profitable. Like, it's like the profitability is not just on the film. It's on how it's on the home release of it. It's how the zeitgeist is discussing it.
Like, I mean, it's how you get Hasbro in the room, though. Yeah. Right? Like, it's the only way that you convince Hasbro that it's worth making this movie is the promise that on the back end, they're going to be able to sell more toys for it. Right. Like that's why
we have seven like Michael Bay style movies.
I mean, yeah, and like to be clear, we've mentioned this on the show before for sure, but like this is also why Transformers even exists as a thing in the first place, like a TV show and comics and stuff. It's like, yeah, like this is coming from a position of, we want to sell robot toys. Let's make a show, or like let's make a comic, or let's write a book, or some reason why people want to buy those toys. Like that is the whole heart of Transformers.
Transformers is a commercial. G.I. Joe is a commercial. Any show you loved in the 80s was a commercial.
I mean, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was a giant commercial, for the toys that you could buy.
Oh my God. Especially the competitions that were going on at the Mirage studio offices to design new characters for Playmates, because they like, we don't have enough characters to keep selling toys. So you design something and Playmates buys it, you're getting all the profits that figure makes. Like, that was the competition. And they only have 6 slots for this wave of figures. So good luck. That's why they morphed everything. That's why every animal became a mutant in the Ninja Turtles line, because the show was still selling toys. Yeah. Which also, while we have Hasbro like on the tip of our tongues, that G.I. Joe Wrath of Cobra game that I played, where I said story mode is just basically arcade mode, turns out it's not supposed to be. Watched a review of the game that the guy's like, I can't even call this a review, it's a PSA, to be like, don't buy the game right now, but I have spoken with the creators and they have a big patch coming, and if that patch ever happens, then we can have a discussion about it, but right now it's unplayable. That was the Flying Kick on YouTube's review, and he actually gets special thanks because he helped make the game better after the disappointing demo. So like, this is a guy, he signed an NDA, so he can't say too much about it, which is why he's like, this isn't a review, it's a PSA. The game is unplayable right now. And in that review, he talks about the fact that there are cutscenes that are supposed to play before every level, but they just don't. Or if they do, it's when they decide to. And then he showed himself reloading a level 4, 5, 6 times before it started with the cutscene. So like,
Jesus.
Yeah. My whole thing of like, it's just an arcade mode. No, it's supposed to have cutscene. And like, he showed the cutscene and the whole line about like, they're making clones of themselves, Cobra Commander and Destro. Like, it's a fight between Clone Commander and Cobra Commander about who is the actual Cobra Commander. And it's like perfect fucking G.I. Joe shit. That game, it's still not in a playable condition, according to somebody who worked to make
it. It's me. Listen here, you shit sipper.
Do you think I would allow the clone to speak to me in such a manner?
Listen to his voice. Clearly he's the fake one.
This one sounds like Steve Buscemi. Steve Buscemi, by the way, since we do an Adam Sandler podcast, he voiced Starscream in Transformers 1. And it was awesome. Like, really a big thing. And again, like, it's to sell toys. I came home and I immediately bought a D16 model kit. Who D16 becomes? That's a mystery for another time. But I will say it plays heavily into my theory about how this film was originally written. Which is batshit. And I hope that you see the movie and then I can tell you all about it. Contact me at the Discord, or I'm still on Twitter at Devin D. Decker. And I will share my insane theory. Also, once it goes up with That Toy Makes Me Happy, This Toy Makes Me Happy, and Sean of the Pokemon Nuzlocke stuff, I will make sure that everybody can see that video where we just go spoiler heavy on Transformers 1 for an hour. We're giving ourselves an hour because I think we could probably.
Which one of them transforms into Shia LaBeouf?
None of them. That's the best part about Transformers 1. You're walking through the forest, you think you're alone, and then it turns out you are. But yeah. I also saw Kevin Smith's new movie, The 4:30 Movie, because it came out on October 1st. I'm going to wait until you see it. I'm going to give a little bit of time on this one, right? I'll give it the 2 weeks before I dive into it. I'm just going to say I wasn't a fan, and I'm going to leave it at that. But if you're a Kevin Smith fan, you should probably check it out. I'll say this. It all takes place at a place that Sejohn and I have been together. So that was kind of interesting. The movie theater across from the secret stash, you know.
Nice.
So it was like a lot of thoughts about Sejohn and the show while we're watching it. And then it ends with another place that Sejohn and I have been, but I'm not going to spoil that surprise for the listener, but I bet Sejohn knows, right? I bet he knows. I'll confirm with him off camera afterwards. I don't want to ruin it for anybody. But yeah, it was interesting, but it felt very derivative of another film. And I don't want to say that before people see it or have the chance to see it, because I don't want to color people's interpretation of the film. And that's what I'll say there. But it's out there. 4:30 Movie is out there. I think it released straight to Amazon on October 1st. I don't know of any theaters that are playing it. Also, this seems like a time since we did the Hellboy episode in January. Hellboy, the Crooked Man. That's not going to theaters in America.
Yeah.
It released in theaters on September 27th in the UK. So there are some reviews from people. And honestly, I am only parroting. I have not seen it. I'm still excited to see it, right? Then again, I liked the Hellboy one where he was King Arthur, basically. Hellboy 2019. There is a lot of feeling that like they made the movie just to make sure they can hold the license, which kind of sucks. But I'm still excited to see it. So that's coming out, I think, this next week, right? When is Crooked Man supposed to release? Vamp, Sejohn, vamp.
I am also looking forward to it still. Again, also coming from a place of somebody like that 2019 as well. I don't know. The few things that I have heard about it are people talking about how they don't understand why it's not just more of the Guillermo one, which has just been the problem with the 2019 one and all that. And like, it's just so wild to me how caught up in that version of the character, when in all honesty I love that version of the character. We'll sing its praises up and down the way that movie was made, the respect and the love that Guillermo has for that character and Mignola and all that, like all of that. That is not a page to screen Hellboy.
There is
some Guillermo del Toro-ness up in that film that makes it very unique from the actual comics. And so what people are basically saying is they like Guillermo del Toro movies when they tell me that they want these movies to be more like that. And so like, and I think that that's going to be kind of the key moving forward, looking at these Hellboy movies, because I also think we're probably going to get another one in 5 years when somebody tries again. But we're going to have to start looking at them as the directors that made them and what they look more like in their repertoire, as opposed to looking at them as Hellboy movies. It's the only way that people are going to, I think, be able to kind of break themselves from trying to kind of come back to Hellboy, is because all anybody really wants is Hellboy 3 from Guillermo. And like, I get that. I respect that want, that desire. But like, unless you have Guillermo del Toro in the chair, you're not going to have a good time with that. Look at what happened with the Pacific Rim sequel that like nobody really talks about, because Guillermo, you know, he gave it his consent and all that, but he wasn't involved in the making of it. And lo and behold, it just didn't have that magic, right? Anybody out there that's demanding another Guillermo del Toro like Hellboy, I'm with you on that.
Yeah,
but like,
same here.
These movies are never gonna be that.
Yeah. So it does. It does release direct to video on demand from Ketchup Entertainment on October 8th. So next episode, I know I will have at least seen it. I can't speak for Sejohn, but it is coming. Crooked Man is coming to digital release in America on October 8th. And I'm excited about it, even though all this other stuff that's being said about it. I mean, the first Hellboy movie I did not see until like really this year when we did that very special episode. I had seen bits and pieces of it. I saw The Golden Army and loved it.
and was like, how have I not seen the first one? This is incredible. And then I liked 2019, and I'm just excited for more Hellboy stuff. But I think Sejohn's right. It is the Batman problem, right? We would all love Tim Burton's Batman Forever film, right? We'd all love to see Billy Dee Williams play Two-Face and Marlon Wayans play Robin the way that he was setting up from the 1989 film, right? We're probably not going to get it. That's why they did the comic adaptation. And we got that Batman again, and again, it was not Tim Burton's Batman in the flesh. Haven't seen the Flash. Last DCEU movie that I saw was Black Adam sitting alongside Sejohn, and I really liked it. And then no other movies were like that ever again. based on the marketing, right? Like, I liked Peacemaker too, but that's not a, I mean, that's DCEU, but it's not a movie.
You know
it's
what would have gotten me into a theater?
What?
Batgirl
would have got me into a theater too. Batgirl would still get me into a theater, right?
More so now, right? Yeah, hell yeah.
Like, I don't. Who knows? And it's never gonna happen, right? Because they already wrote it off, and the whole way that thing happens. Maybe someday it'll leak online, right? 20 years from now.
I hope a script comes out at least. I want to at least read a script.
I know. It's just something that I am very interested in. But yeah, so in terms of these, like. Now movies releasing straight to digital is a very normalized thing. So we saw it with the 4:30 movie last week, and we're going to see it with Hellboy the Crooked Man this week. 4:30 movie, again, I try to, you know, do what you can with it. This is what I got to say. I if Sejohn gets to see it, we'll talk about it. But again, it's going to be at least 2 weeks before we talk about that one. Crooked Man, if Sejohn and I can both see it, we'll probably talk about next week, though. Just being completely honest about that. It also fits in with Hollow watching, right?
Yes, like, it does, 100%. Yeah.
So there's a better than good chance on that one. There ain't nothing scary in the 4:30 movie, except for some of its thoughts about women. Yeah. Shaking my head. Last movie I watched was Treasure Planet. And I've been wanting to see Treasure Planet since 2002 when Treasure Planet came out. But again, Discover Weekly. Thanks, Discover Weekly. A song from it was on my Discover Weekly, and I'm like, well, now I need to watch the movie so I can listen to the song. Because I'm an insane person. And I really liked it. I don't understand why it has such a weird, like, feeling about it. Because a lot of people seem to like it as well. Critics like it. Everyone I've talked to about it seem to enjoy it. Why the hate for Treasure Planet?
Well, I don't think there's any hate for Treasure Planet. If I remember correctly, Treasure Planet's one of those ones that was like the last kind of hand-drawn ones that were being kind of worked on at the moment. Not now that we've had history since then where they came back to hand-drawn animation. But I think like Brother Bear is kind of in this world too, I think. Or what's the cow one? Home on the Range.
Yep. That's what I was thinking. Right? Yeah.
So there's a whole slew of these movies at that time that like were kind of like back burner movies that were like, we want to kind of get these done before. And Treasure Planet, I think, is kind of the first of them. It actually comes out a few years really before this phenomenon really kicks into the gear with movies like Home on the Range. But like, there's this idea that it was always kind of a back burner film. And so it's done almost begrudgingly, the movie comes out. And then this is the same thing that kind of happens in not exactly the same, but it's the same result that you get with movies like Emperor's New Groove, right? Or on the DreamWorks side of things, Shrek, where like these were kind of the movies that like because upper management wasn't really pushing on them, but artists were, and they really wanted to get these things done. And then it became kind of hell because of the ways that people were treated on making these movies. It has such a bad kind of sense on the filmmaking side of it that when it lands and it becomes this huge hit, people are scratching their heads like, why does everybody have a bad feeling about this movie? And it's because, from what I understand, the making of that movie was fucking hell.
It has the longest production cycle of any Disney film as of this time, taking 10 years to make. Well, the longest production cycle of any movie post the Renaissance era, right? But production mainly started after Hercules because the two directors on it, let me see if I can find this, John Musker and Ron Clements, they first worked together on The Great Mouse Detective. They wanted to do Black Cauldron, but were given The Great Mouse Detective. Then they're like, oh, we'd like to do this Treasure Planet movie. And they're like, why don't you do The Little Mermaid first? And they're like, okay, then can we do the Treasure Planet movie? And they're like, sure, sure, sure. But we got this movie Aladdin. You guys want to direct Aladdin? And they're like, yes, yes, we'll direct Aladdin. But then can we do Treasure Planet? And they're like, how about Hercules? You guys want to direct Hercules? And they're like, we will direct Hercules if the next movie we can direct is this Treasure Planet movie we've been trying to make since the 80s.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Like, and I think that's pretty emblematic of like kind of everything that went on with that movie. Is like there was just so much that the artists wanted to be doing with that film, and just from the money side, it was like pulling fucking teeth to get anybody to make that movie with them. And then like the end result of that conflict ended up being that a lot of people didn't have a great time making the movie, and thus it kind of had this really weird sour taste in its mouth when it came out. But then like history has borne out that like people really liked that movie, right? And you know, so like I said, not like beat for beat the stories with like Shrek or to bring it more back to Disney Emperor's New Groove, right. But it's that end result for them that they can't ignore when like, oh, but everybody really loves this, so we can't not talk about this movie. We can't bury it like we've done with some of the others.
But it had, by all accounts, there was supposed to be a sequel that was scrubbed because the film didn't perform well. Like, they had already signed on Willem Dafoe to voice Ironbeard in the sequel. And because the first movie like was considered a flop in the theaters, which I don't even know what that means in 2002, right? It was such a weird landscape for films that we have been examining over the course of this series. But like, it's one of those ones that I wanted to skip school to see it. And I was unable to. I was not allowed to skip school to go see Treasure Planet. So it's just kind of been this out-of-reach Disney movie for me. And watching it last night, I'm like, this is excellent. This is everything I love in movies. Like, what? How did I not see this when I was 16 years old?
Like, when did it come out compared to... So that Treasure Planet's like 2001,
2002.
2002.
It came out 2002. The same time I was in Nashville. Before what, the last
when did Titan do you remember when Titan,
Titan AE, I believe,
came out
is 1997.
Fox?
Let me double confirm that.
Titan AE is 2000. So Titan AE comes out in the year 2000, and Treasure Planet kind of also, I think, kind of falls into the shadow of that. Titan AE is a phenomenal film.
I love Titan AE.
Like,
so good.
But like the sci-fi like nature, the idea that they are trying to literally create planets in that movie, like there's this whole kind of aspect of Titan AE kind of looming over animation that by the time Disney finally puts out Treasure Planet, it looks like it's a failed attempt at we want one of those. Even though, as you pointed out, the guys trying to make it have been trying to make it for 10 years. So it does kind of really feel like then suddenly Disney execs are like, oh, animated sci-fi films are actually cool now? Okay, well, yeah, you could do your Treasure Planet then. Like, go ahead.
Yeah, it's so strange because you're not wrong. Like, that was definitely a thought I had, and we discussed, like, when did Titan AE came out in relation to this? And I just never got a chance to look it up, right? I was falling asleep last night after watching this movie that I enjoyed, but there's something about the Treasure Island story that puts me to sleep. I have never seen Muppet Treasure Island in its entirety because I always fall asleep at We Got Cabin Fever. And then I've nice. Never seen past that scene. I'm not even sure if movie exists beyond that scene. I'm going to be that crazy person who, like, I think Cabin Fever happens and then the movie ends.
Yeah, so Treasure Planet, just to put some numbers to the madness, just so that we're talking about, was $140 million to make, supposedly. You know, this is 2002, as we pointed out, so who knows what these numbers reflect, really. And only managed to pull together about $110 million altogether. Gotcha. So, like, most of that even being international. No, like, the majority of that was international. So, yeah, not a huge success at all at the time, but, like, also... The more and more that movie sticks around, the more and more people talk about, man, I really loved Treasure Planet.
I actually have to join with that. The marketing budget for it, advertising, was $40 million because they, rather than like rework the film, what they decided to do was just push the marketing on it so that people would want to go see it. Like, it's one of the last times where they're like, there are some issues with this, but rather than change the movie, we're just going to convince people that they have to see it, which is why they know
like
how much they dumped into it. Yeah. And that $140 million, this is the most expensive traditionally animated film ever made. which is just crazy to think about, is beautiful too. Like, it really is a beautiful film. I was sad when I'm like, yeah, it didn't do really well. But then, like, I can understand if it lost like $79 million overall, that being a big problem for them. And also, I honestly think we talk about the problems with marketing all the time. The marketing that I remember for this movie is literally the first 5 minutes of the film. It's is Jim Hawkins on his little solar sled. And that's all the marketing is for the movie. And that's how the movie opens. And then, like, that's not what the rest of the movie is. So, like,
yeah, this, no, I had that toy, though.
Yeah, of course you. Yeah, why wouldn't you? But, like, this freewheeling kind of, like, cloud surfing a la Cloud Kicker from Tailspin sort of, like, version of the character that they tell you. At the beginning of the movie, he gets arrested and that gets confiscated from him. Like, that, like, all the stuff that you were excited to see in this movie, that doesn't really happen. And it feels like, I hate Tarzan, by the way. I'm not a big fan of Disney's Tarzan. I'm just going to put it out there. But even as somebody who just said the words, I hate Tarzan, I'm not a big fan of Disney's Tarzan, I will admit that the marketing for that movie was Tarzan skateboarding on tree limbs. And that's, like, all he fucking does in that movie. Which is not why I don't like it. As much as I love Invisible Touch and Phil Collins with Genesis, I'm not a big fan of Phil Collins' music alone, is something that I will admit. So I don't love the music in that movie. And, like, yeah. I love Tarzan. Tarzan is one of the stories that I'm a big fan of. And, like, it's kind of a weak adaptation of the Tarzan story. Like, in my opinion, right? That's my opinion on that one. Like, there have been crazy good Tarzan adaptations, and that one just feels so... I mean, it's for kids, right? So, like, they shy away from a lot of the more violent moments in his life, and they don't really show any of the stuff where he goes back to civilization, right?
Yeah.
It's primarily in the dungeon. Yeah. The dichotomy of it, right? Even George of the Jungle knew, we need to see George in the city. Like, that has to be part of what we see this character doing. Otherwise, you're missing the point of it. Sorry.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed Treasure Planet.
Loved it. It was so good. So that's it. I mean, I, like, overall, movie-wise, Transformers 1, go fucking see it. Seriously. If you're somebody who was excited to go see Joker 2 this week, but, like, on, like, a cheap Tuesday or Wednesday, depending on your franchise, and all of the fervor around the film or what you've been hearing about it has turned you off, if your theater is still showing Transformers 1, Transformers 1 is excellent. It is so good. So, like, that's a thumbs up from me. Watching the original Joker again of, like, full mind and body and spirit, I understand why it did as well as it did, right? Because there's a good movie there. There's a good story there. And maybe if they only gave him $55 million to make the second movie, they would have gotten that again. I don't know. Joker 2 was a waste of my time, kind of. I'm glad I saw it. I will admit that. It wasn't a waste of my time. I'm glad that I've seen the movie. I'm glad that I was able to form an opinion of it. I think that Lady Gaga did a great job. I think that Joaquin Phoenix did a great job. I was just so nervous about the messaging that it was, like, sending out to people who liked the first movie. But people who like the first movie hate the second movie. So, like, crisis averted. I say that now, right? Who knows what the future of that film's going to be, right? One guy into the echo chamber of the internet says the things that I'm afraid of him saying, and there could be a groundswell, right? Next week, the guys could go in fucking clown masks to support this film so it's not a failure. Right? Because he is still their icon for some fucking reason.
Well, and the bigger thing for me about the whole Joker stuff is, I talked about this when the first one came out, but, like, I don't love the ways in which it affirms some stuff but obviously people thought it was interesting to have a way to look into that world, right? It feels like, though, that when you have a sequel now, and we've made a franchise out of it, and we've gone back to that world, now it's like hard to ignore the exploitive nature. My issues of the exploitiveness of the first one and the ways in which some people weren't going to see that movie for what it was, get the wrong message. You know, we've talked about this with movies for a while now. You know, you've mentioned Kevin Smith and things that happened with Clerks, but you know, the same thing with Fight Club. It's the Fight Club problem, right? Emulating the wrong person. You talk about the incel nature of Arthur Fleck in that first movie, and the issues that I have with the ways in which it doesn't really truly call that out enough. Like, it shows it, sure, but it doesn't then like interrogate it in any meaningful way, meaning that a lot of people that are already leaning in that direction see that, and they see it as affirmation of their feelings and their choices to do some pretty grody things, right? And then like there were people that were just like, oh, you know, it's a balancing act. You have to talk about it. You have to point it out and all of that. And it's like, fine. You want to, you know, you want to be okay with it. Like, I, your taste and my taste are different. Fine. The second that a sequel comes into play, it is so much harder to have that argument where it's just like, this feels super exploitive, guys, to the point where we have now come back 5 years later and done it again. And it's like, yeah, I think that this one might be a bridge too far. It's like, right. Yes, exactly.
And I can't believe that it seems to be. Like, I'm so happy, like, society, as broken as it is, that they were able to acknowledge how exploitive doing another Joker film is, right? Like, right. And so far...
Of that particular mindset, right.
Yeah, exactly. I am happy. I don't want to be happy that it's failing, right? You don't want anything to really fail. But I am happy that it seems like people realized why that first film maybe wasn't the best messaging, maybe wasn't the best type of people who were like celebrating it.
Yes.
That's nice.
Yeah.
I don't know. And then, God, Transformers 1. Just one more thing. I was alone in the theater. I forgot how good that feels. I mean, Joker yeah. Deux, I was one of seven people in the theater. But it's still not the same as being alone in a movie theater. And it's Transformers, right? And as much as I am, like, Zach is a bigger Transformer fan, right? My friend Zach is, like, the reason why I'm still a Transformers fan. I will admit that. That and, like, some of the other friends that I've made in the community who remind me of, like, oh, remember this character that you like, Devon Decker? They just did a new figure of him. And it's like, why did you tell me that? Now I need to have him. Now I need to go out and find him, you son of a bitch. Right? And that it's just a fact of what Transformers is, right? They are the most nostalgic of the 80s cartoons and characters. And I say that because, like, one could make a really good argument for the Ninja Turtles thing, but the Ninja Turtles issue is that people who collect Ninja Turtles stuff, it's a compulsion. They just see that it's Turtles and have to buy it, which is, like, the full-on exploitation that NECA is doing with the Turtle right. stuff. And as somebody who, like, I will raise my hand and be like, I'm Devon Decker and I'm addicted to Ninja Turtle toys in 2024. I have identified it and I am ready for the 40th anniversary to be over, because that is how I'm justifying a lot of my purchases. Is like, oh, but it's this figure that we've never gotten before because it's the 40th anniversary. And like, they're not going to have that salve for me next year. Right?
Right.
It's going to have to be hopefully. Stuff that hopefully, right? But I'm already there. Like, I went to Target this morning because they did the Punk Turtles 4-pack. And, you know, Leo and Raphael have episodes where they're in that same basic outfit, but the jackets are different colors. So they have now released a 2-pack of just Raph and Leo in their alternate jacket colors. And, like, I was looking for that this morning because it was supposed to release this weekend. And I'm like, man, I am done. Like, I feel gross that this is how I'm spending my morning. Right? Like, it's because it's Raphael. If it were Leo and Donnie alternate jackets, I don't think I'd be doing it. But, like, I know that, like, this is a sickness and I am identifying it. And I know that I'm getting a little bit better. Because when the only thing I found was black and white Usagi Yojimbo dressed as a samurai, I didn't buy that feeling the need to, like, continue buying things. I am looking for a specific set of figures. And it's not like, well, I can buy this Bebop and Rocksteady set so that I bought something so the trip wasn't for naught. I'm not doing that, and I'm pretty happy about that.
But good for you.
Thank you. But I can't say that about other people in it, right? And there might be some Transformers fans who also just buy out of compulsion, but the big thing that they do is, oh, well, like, we'll just call this character Skywarp. And there's a bunch of people who, like, will need to buy the figure because it's named Skywarp, even though it's not a jet and it's not black and purple. They're still going to feel compelled because it has the name Skywarp on it. And I mean, I that's me. That's my confession about Transformers. But it was fun being alone in the theater for Transformers 1 and identifying all the characters and be like, holy fuck, it's Skywarp. Oh my God, it's freaking Thundercracker. Crosscut, Silverstreak, Bluestreak, Sunstreaker. They're the Streak Brothers. Like, it was fun yelling out because there was nobody there to be like, shut the fuck up. I'm trying to watch the Transformers movie. I don't need to know every obscure character that comes up on screen. Chromia won the freaking race. It was excellent. All these references that I'm like, these are characters I love. They're all the obscure dudes. I think that's it for me, though. Echoes of Wisdom. I am in the end game now. And I only know that because, I mean, what have you done in Echoes of Wisdom? Let's do an Echoes of Wisdom check.
I'm still dinking around with the Zora at the moment.
Nice.
I wanted to make sure that I met the both of the camps before I ventured into Jabu. But yeah, that's
very cool. Very cool. So you've completed the desert then, at least, right?
Oh yes. Right, yep.
Good. Yeah. So have you found the dojo? Is the question I'm going to have to ask.
The sleeping dojo. Dream dojo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the only reason that I know I'm in the end game, because I still felt like I had a lot of game left, is I went back to him and I completed the sleep trainings that I had. And he's like, mm-hmm. Congratulations, you're now the ultimate snorier. And I'm like, I beat all the challenges? Oh, that means the game's almost over. Right?
Yeah, starting to wrap stuff up, Dad.
Yeah, I'm like, no. So I, yeah. And it's, I'm excited for you to be finished with it so we can give it a full-on, like, big read. I have to say this to people. Thank you to everybody, Lance especially, for sending me speedruns of Echoes of Wisdom. I need to finish the game first. So if we could stop that until you hear that I have finished the game, it would be appreciated. Because, yes, I am interested in these speedruns. Because let's see if the leaderboard is open and we see how fast people are beating the game so far. The speedrun.com Echoes of Wisdom is not on the top. You know what we can talk about while I'm looking this up? F-099, did you see that they added the Satellaview cars and courses? Like, the Ace League is there? Like, that is fucking huge. That is such a big thing for them to do. Like, I don't know if people fully understand that is deprecated lost media being restored via F-099.
Yeah.
So four new cars and at least five new tracks that were only ever available on Satellaview, which, like, most of the Satellaview stuff is deprecated because it was one time play only via the Satellaview adapter in Japan. Right. And they've saved some stuff, but that is huge. And regarding the leaderboards for Echoes of Wisdom, this actually is fair. This is a fair thing to anyone who wants to send me information about speedruns for Echoes of Wisdom. They open as of the time of this recording. So it is 1:10 p.m. on October 6th. In 3 days, 22 hours, 49 minutes and 15 seconds as of right now. So, like, You in 4 days, well, I guess from when this releases, in 3 days from when this episode releases, that is when the doors will be open and you can send me everything you want to about Echoes of Wisdom. Because if I don't finish the game in the next 3 days, then something happened to me. because I'm like, I feel like I'm that close to the end.
All right, man. I'm excited to hear where you get.
Yeah. And I'm excited for you to experience things. I don't want to say the thing that I want, that like this game is making me feel inside, but I'm so happy that those are the feelings that are welling up inside of me. Like, and I'm so happy to hear about what you take away from your time with the Zora. Especially as somebody who did the Zora first. Like, I got to go to Gerudo Village and share my experiences with people. Like, that whole, what do you mean you missed the sandstorm thing? You and Dale are not the only people I had that conversation with.
Well, because there's a whole mini-boss attached to it. So, like, you're saying you missed a mini-boss is what you're saying. You missed a whole section there.
I mean, I found it now, and I took care of it.
Right. So you didn't miss it. You just did it at a different time, Dev. That's the problem with that. That people are having with your statement. I think you're confusing people's confusion with you saying you skipped a part of the game with them being, like, amazed at your talent to do that. No, we're amazed that you cheated yourself out of a section of the game.
Okay, that's fair. That's understandable.
That's not impressive.
It's sad. You cheated not only yourself, but the game. I didn't use any cheat codes, though. It's just I somehow was undeterred by, like, not knowing where I was in the desert.
I mean, the thing is that the sandstorm lasts from, like, 5 tiles to 5 tiles, and you don't really lose that much vision.
Yeah.
So, like, if you're saying that you weren't that impressed with the sandstorm, yeah, I think there's something to be said that the sandstorm that they talk about is very silly, and, like, your map kind of goes staticky, but again, it only really does in, like, a 25-tile radius. Like, it's not really that big of a deterrent. If you know you're supposed to head north, just keep walking north. That's the other thing, is that the sandstorm in Breath of the Wild, very specifically, will actually turn you around. It'll actually change the ways in which Link traverses the world, which is why it's so easy to get lost in that one. That doesn't happen in this one. If you are pressing north on your stick, you continue to walk north, and the same with east, west, and south. Right? You don't actually get lost in the sandstorm like you do in some other Zelda games.
Yeah, and I guess, like, that's part of it is the fact that, like, I didn't even notice it, and somehow, and I have been talking to people. I'm not, because I don't want to miss a quest, so I'm making sure to talk to everybody, and yet somehow I just did not talk to the one Gerudo who's like, man, we've been having sandstorm problems. Someone should deal with that.
Yeah, and I mean, and all it is it's all pointing to a mini-boss.
Right.
We want you to defeat, then that sandstorm disappears. And it's cool. That's one of my other favorite things so far, is I did stop off and do the cloud, the electro cloud boss there.
In the Eastern Palace?
In the Eastern Palace. Yeah. Just because I was walking along and I saw this guy standing outside of it who was like, I heard a voice inside.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, fine, I'm going to go inside and see what the voice is. And I didn't realize what I was getting myself into.
Those have been one of my favorite parts about the game is, like, bosses who are, like, not, like, optional bosses, essentially.
Because
that cloud fight, like, you say that, like, that was boss level difficult, and I really enjoyed it. And, like,
but I think that is in that same vein as the solving the sandstorm problem in the desert. It's like, it's completely optional, not necessary, not really a huge hindrance if you don't do it, but, like, it's a very fun thing to do because, like, you get to go up against these cool, like, villains and stuff that you don't normally get to play against. It's a very cool little aspect of this game that I'm enjoying.
I definitely have to go back to the desert because I mean, I fought two of those things out there. And my memory from Link to the Past, which is where they are definitely from, is that there were three. So I wonder if there is a third that I am just missing or if it is just two at this point. Because, I mean, they're Land Molas, spoilers, but it made me very happy that they're Land Molas from Link to the Past. The game is so Link to the Past coded, it makes me so happy.
Yeah, it definitely is in that Link to the Past, Link Between Worlds, like area. It's just, I'd be very, very curious to talk about, like, how it could possibly fit into that timeline with the ways in which people, we've talked about this last week, how people do and don't remember certain events.
Yeah, we'll talk about it once everything's done. Because it feels like it might be a new series in the timeline, and it would have to be significantly after Link to the Past, based on things that have not happened for you yet. So we will discuss, and I look forward to that discussion. All right. Anything else you want to tease the people with or say about this episode of the Say Report?
No, I mean, we're getting into the spooky season, so I'm excited about that. Definitely want to check out Hellboy this week, so I encourage everybody to. Yep. And I think that's the other thing is, like, check that movie out and prove them wrong. They're like, those bastards didn't want to put it in theaters because nothing is working in theaters right now. And, like, let's prove them wrong. Let's find something and watch it.
Yeah, right. Say Report. See the Crooked Man for the Say Report. Let's do it. See the Crooked Man for Hellboy, right? And for all these people who like that, like, let's at least watch it, right? Let's go back to we can put movies in and people might see them and they might not love them, but we still got their money for seeing it. That sounds toxic in a way, but I don't know. All right, that's enough from me.
Or, you know, be able to find enjoyment in a thing that you don't think is perfect art. Like, there's, because if you spend your whole life searching for only perfect art to enjoy, you're going to be miserable because you'll find one thing a decade, maybe, that you consider to be perfect.
I mean, that's what I tell people when they're like, how have you been doing a podcast for so long? And I'm like, honestly, we just did it. Like, you can't hope for the perfect moment to start your podcast, and you can't hope that every episode's going to be perfect, right? Some of them are going to have imperfections, and it's the imperfections that reveal perfection. Bicentennial Man. Somehow, maybe. I don't know. If you've enjoyed this episode of the Say Report, you can keep the conversation going in our Discord. You can find invitations on our social media sites located at Facebook and X, formerly Twitter. Or you can contact us directly at thesayreport@gmail.com and request an invite there. Or if you're old school and just want to have an email correspondence with us, then you can always send emails to thesayreport@gmail.com. And if it's specifically for myself or for Sejohn, put it in the subject line and our non-existent intern will make sure it is distributed appropriately. With that in mind, let's all go to NashVegas while Will brings us home. Have a good one, everybody.
Thank you for listening to the Say Report with your host Devon Decker and Sejohn Serwick. Please follow the guys on Twitter and Facebook by searching for The Say Report, and you can always subscribe on your podcast channel so this is delivered straight to you and you can enjoy it every week. With apologies to your mother, we'll see you next time.